Well, good afternoon again, and welcome to everyone. I haven't had a chance to meet everyone yet. My name is Michael McLean. I'm a professor of eco-hydrology here at UNESCO-IHE. And since 2013, I've been the head of the Hydrology and Water Resources Chair Group, and therefore responsible, along with my colleagues, for the specialization in hydrology, that version of the international course for hydrology that lives on and, as you'll see later, really is thriving today. We've come together to celebrate 50 years of this program, and I'm so happy with the mix of people that have joined us. We have a number of colleagues who have been important in the program for many, many years that are going to be able to bring a historical perspective, as well as their latest thoughts and guidance for the future, to this discussion. And we bring this all the way up to our most recent and current group of participants. You are, of course, what this program is really all about being able to prepare you well to return to your professional lives and have an impact in the way that hydrologists have impact on the world. So thank you to you all. Also, thank you if you are joining us online. We are live streaming this event, and although we can't hear you, we have created an opportunity for you to communicate with us. I hope that you see on the screen, in addition to the program for today, you see on the lower right-hand corner an email address. All lowercase, one string, ihehydrology50@gmail.com. Please note that down, and you all remind me to now and then remind people of that, because this slide won't appear again. But you can write to us. There's someone in the audience who's receiving these emails, and it can be a comment, it can be a question, and we'll try to bring you into the conversation. So please identify yourself, and of course, write whatever comment you have. So you've seen the program. We have a mix of looking at the hydrology program today, where we are and what we're doing. But we also recognize, and this program has recognized from the beginning, that we operate within a larger hydrological community, especially among our neighbors here in the Netherlands. So Hoop Savanai is going to share with us a broader perspective of hydrological education and the research aspects of that across the Netherlands. This day is equally important as a celebration of 25 years of continuous service by Dr. Yang Xiao Zhao. And we will hand the podium to Yang Xiao, both to provide a historical perspective on this program. He arrived just in the months before the 25th anniversary of this program and was very active in that celebration. I know a number of other people in the audience were as well. And he's been a continual contributor and really a foundation of the program, along with a few others in the intervening years. So Yang Xiao will have an opportunity to share his perspective and also to share some of his experiences, 25 years in the program. And then, of course, the greatest product that we produce is trained and skilled people. And of course, some of you are in the room now, but we also are inviting a couple of our esteemed alumni, hydrologists that have risen to professional levels where they're having an enormous impact here and abroad. So we'll have two of our alumni, both Menno and Andrea, will speak from the alumni perspective. And I think that many of you in the room know them more from a professor or a lecturer or a head of an institution, of a director of an institution perspective. But they were graduates of this program, just as many of you will be. And we not only want to talk about the program today and where we've been, where we've come from, but we very much want to look toward the future. We understand that we as hydrologists have a large role in contributing knowledge and understanding necessary to tackle some of the largest challenges that we face internationally in the arena of water. So we're organizing a panel of professors from neighboring institutions, universities in the Netherlands, who are each going to be able to provide their perspective on that future and what are some of the critical issues that we need to tackle, and we'll join in a discussion during that period. So a lot of good ideas will be raised, some historical perspective, knowledge of the program today, the future, and then we'll have a chance to decompress and discuss our thoughts in a reception that will follow. But to begin, it's my pleasure to introduce our acting rector, Fritz Holsworth, who's going to address you and kick off the event. Fritz, please.
Thank you very much, Michael. Good afternoon. And if I see the auditorium, it's very difficult to welcome persons personally, because I think it would be important to welcome each and everyone sitting in the auditorium personally. So I will not go that direction. I see that the competence of hydrology in this institute over the time is sitting here. There is one important person not amongst us, and I explicitly send his greetings because I had a brief contact with him. It's Stefan Uhlenbrock, and Stefan really is a bit sad that he was not able to travel and to come to Delft, because he is also one of the important pillars in this program. I'm a bit hesitant to talk about hydrology because I'm not an hydrologist by profession, and I think the competence is more represented in the auditoriums than on my side. But in my whole professional life, I always appreciated that hydrology provided me and us, they are working in the field of water management, with knowledge, with scientific evidence, with a basis for working in river basins. And I think this is something what I became more aware when preparing for this afternoon, that a lot of things we are doing today would not have been possible without having hydrology as a young, in the meantime a bit more adult, science in the whole concert of environmental sciences. And I think it is also important to mention that today we take it for granted that we can manage water in a river basin. Before, without having hydrology, where we got a common language and a common understanding, where we got common methodologies how to deal with, where modeling helped us to develop flood forecast systems, for example, there I think is an important element working on this issue and educating our students on this issue. I think this is still very important. To understand the water cycle in a river basin, I think is important if you like to go for a proper implementation of the magic European Water Framework Directive. If there would be not a serious understanding about that, it would be very difficult. And I think all the progress we made in the last 20 to 25 years, if it comes to flood forecasting in river basins and the improvements we made, it would be difficult without hydrology. So I think it is important that we have this event, 50 years, to look a bit back, to look especially forward where we are, and to contextualize where are the interlinkages of hydrology with other parts of the environmental sciences. What I find quite interesting, I had a look on the program and the themes of the working groups of the meeting of the International Association of Hydrological Science next year in South Africa. And I was quite fascinated how you link up with important developments and not seeing just water and not see interlinkages. And therefore, I think hydrology is a scientific discipline really links up with important processes around us, even with social science. I also think there are a lot of challenges ahead of us. In the very beginning, water quantity was the only focus. Everybody was looking about on water availability and water quantity. But in the meantime, it became clear that quantity and quality are the same, are two sides of the same coin, and we cannot simply separate it. An important challenge I find also when I see the developments in other parts of the natural sciences, how are we going to be able to link up the climate models with the hydrological models? Because it is very clear that there is a close interlinkage, but it is also clear that there is still an important gap which has to be closed. There are a lot of attempts to do that, but I think there is a big challenge, because if I see the discussion in the climate community and in the water community, we are talking about water scarcity, we are talking about the issue of adaptation, and say very simply that adaptation is primarily water and land use, and I think therefore it is important to see some models on the climate side and the models on the hydrological side and try to link up the two. I think there is a long list to you have also in your meeting in South Africa. And finally, I would like to express my gratitude to all staff in the Institute, the staff today teaching hydrology, but also the predecessors, they teach hydrology. And I think it is important to use this day today to make us aware that without hydrology, we would not be able to address a lot of the challenges we have to deal with today. So I wish you a successful afternoon. I wish you that there is an important exchange, and I have to apologize that I have to go back to my office, but I come back later on. So I'm not leaving because I'm not interested in the various themes you're presenting and discussing this afternoon. But before Christmas, sometimes you have the impression that everything has to happen and there is no time left afterwards. So thank you very much for coming, and I wish you really a fruitful and inspiring afternoon.
Thank you very much, and I do hope you'll return, especially for our discussion with the panel in the end about the future, because so many of the points you were raising are among those that we'll need to consider. All right, before I leave the slide, in case there have been any others joining us via the live stream, just a final reminder that on the bottom right-hand side of the screen, you'll see an email address, ihehydrology50@gmail.com, where you can send comments or you can ask questions. It's an opportunity for you who is joining us virtually to participate in the conversation. But let me continue. And you'll see that I'm the first speaker on the list of speakers. I have limited time, and I'm also responsible for time. So I'm going to do my best to move through this quickly. This presentation is really to just give you a sense for the program today, where we are, what we're prioritizing, who we are. So let me begin with that. So again, it focuses on the hydrology and water resources program today. Now, today we are one of 14 Delft-based specializations in water here at the institution. These are organized among four different master's programs that you'll see here in the blue headings, in the white text in the blue, a master's program in environmental science, another in urban water and sanitation, the program in water management, and the lower MSc is the program in water science and engineering. And you'll see at the very bottom of that list, the specialization in hydrology. That has actually been a little bit of an irritation for me through the years. It's just purely the outcome of an alphabetical list of all of these possibilities, and somehow we end up at the bottom of this list every time a list of specializations is given. But honestly, I've come to appreciate it, right? Because we're at the bottom of the list, but we are also the science and the program that studies the resource, the occurrence and the dynamics and the interactions of that resource that is the foundation for everything else. So I think we're right to be at the bottom. We are the foundation for so many of these other programs, and hydrology is distributed among many of them. All right, so we're one of many programs in the institution, and those of us teaching in the program all, you know, have some level of teaching and interaction with other programs as well, which is, of course, critical. What are our current learning objectives that we prioritize in the program? First is understanding, an in-depth understanding of theories and concepts in both surface and subsurface hydrology, as well as the physical, the chemical, and the biological interactions of the hydrosphere, the lithosphere, the biosphere, and the atmosphere. So understanding those theories and concepts, being aware as well of the natural and human-induced variations in that hydrological system, the perturbations to the cycle, the long-term pressures as well as the periodic pulses, and how this impacts the system, how the system recovers, how it can be best understood and managed. And finally, you know, ensuring that these few learning objectives, ensuring that those who go through the master's program, the specialization here, are up to date and familiar with the larger science and community of sciences. So a focus on good knowledge of the literature and contemporary research questions in hydrology. What do we want the graduates of these programs, of this program, to possess? First, we want them to be able to apply and integrate these principles and concepts. We want to see that they are able to master the major hydrological methodologies and applications. We want them to have the skills to evaluate and analyze hydrological systems and processes at a range of scales for many purposes. We want them to have the skill and the ability to design and conduct hydrological research and experiments to conduct the studies that will generate the needed information in the areas where they develop professionally. But in addition to all of these very specific hydrologically focused skills, we also want to make sure that the graduates of these programs are aware of the importance of hydrology to society and the relationships between our science and other disciplines such as ecology, meteorology, climatology, into the social sciences as well. I mean, there's more and more of our work is seamlessly linking with socioeconomic dynamics and systems. And finally, we want to make sure that we support our participants to emerge with the skills to cooperate within a multidisciplinary and an interdisciplinary framework. Could even go to transdisciplinary. Now, we're an international program. That's what it was called in the beginning, of the International Course in Hydrology. And of course, the institute itself strives and has a focus on international participants. And we continue that tradition today. Now, these are just the current participants in our 18-month Delft-based program. So this is, of course, two cohorts of participants, those who have finished their coursework and are now in their research phase, as well as those who have begun their coursework, many of the participants in the audience now. But as we look at the distribution across the globe, we see a strong representation from Africa, representation from Europe, even though the Europeans that tend to come here are Europeans that have lived and worked abroad and internationally as well, so they bring a global perspective. Central, Eastern Asia, Southeast Asia, strong representation today and through the years, and also a good representation from the Americas. So really an extraordinary diversity of international backgrounds, of levels of expertise. If we were to go through the individual qualifications of each of these participants, it's extraordinary the number of years of experience and work that they've been doing already. And of course, that enriches our program very well. You'll see on the left here that we currently have over 30 participants in the Delft-based program from more than 20 countries. We also are participants in an Erasmus Mundus program that's recently started, that Tibor Stichter has really led the development of that. And that's also just proven extraordinarily successful, focusing on groundwater in particular, and groundwater in the context of global change. We've, of course, been reading, and there's such a discussion about the role that groundwater can play in that uncertain future of water availability due to climate change. And this program addresses some of those specific topics. And it itself, in addition to the Delft-based program, has over 30 participants that are distributed over the class that includes 2 years' worth of students, and more than 15 countries. I'm not sure what the total number is, Tibor, but it's also quite extraordinary. And there's an intermixing of these students with those in the Delft-based program. I'll show you where that happens. Who are we today? Who is the teaching staff? You'll see that we are 10 strong at various levels in our career. And we also include Tom Bogart. The first point there, Tom is at the TU Delft, but we have a cooperative program with Hoops Group there, so that we exchange our time and efforts in teaching in each other's programs, in sharing responsibility for graduate students, and of course conducting research together. Just to point out a couple of other key ones, you see Jochen Wenninger in the center bottom. He's currently the coordinator of the program. And then, of course, we have to feature Yang Shao, who is celebrating 25 years in the program as well. Now, these are the core staff, full-time, partial-time contracts here at UNESCO-IHE. Of course, the hydrology program has relied on guest lecturers and has benefited so much from the diverse expertise of guest lecturers through the years. In the past, there was a larger number of guest lecturers in the program. But with time, the contracted staff here has been taking over many of those responsibilities, but we still rely on guest lecturers. Some of them you'll see who are with us today. And those across the top, with Mark and Kos and Vim, are especially contributing to the Erasmus Mundus program on groundwater and global change, and others are contributing specifically to our Delft-based program. So, how's the program composed? Just to walk you through it very, very quickly. As most of you know, but some of you haven't been updated on the program in some time, it's organized into 18 months, and the first year, the first 12 months, is a taught component, and the program begins, as you see, with two foundation or leveling modules. At this point, they're 3 weeks each, and at this point, these modules serve the entire participant population of the Water Science and Engineering Master's Program. So this is a very large class where our hydrologists are blended with their colleagues from other specializations. But moving into Module 3, that's in this hourglass shape of our program, from broad into narrow and focused specialization training. At Module 3, our participants enter the specialization training. And they begin with strong theory courses in hydrogeology, steady and transient flow, and then surface hydrology, looking at the energy and the hydrological balance, soil, water, and evaporation, stepping into some conceptual catchment modeling and the like. So conceptual foundations, surface and subsurface, and then also learning about becoming aware of the hydrochemistry, the biogeochemistry interactions with the hydrological cycle, and monitoring those water quality aspects as well as the water quantity itself. And in Module 6, beginning to apply some of that chemical knowledge to use the hydrochemistry as a tracer, and isotopes are added at that point as another important tracer, in order to define the behavior of flow systems and trace the movement of water from its source and some of the interactions that it undergoes through the program, in the hydrological cycle. As we move into Modules 7 and 8, you'll see a splitting. And they're shaded a different color because these are officially within the Water Science and Engineering program. These are electives that can be taken. But many of our participants will continue along these tracks. And you'll see that Module 7 focuses on data processing, data collection, interpretation, either focusing on the surface or the groundwater aspects. Moving into Module 8, there's integrated modeling aspects of these. And this is at the point where our Erasmus Mundus participants have joined as well. They've already been here, but they also will have a dedicated module for themselves on groundwater and adaptation to global climate impacts. From there, we head to the field, catchment in southern France, and we also have a field trip to explore in Italy at this point and look at different waterworks. And this is, again, combining with other specializations, so there's a chance for interaction there. Module 10 is applied groundwater modeling, and then Module 11 is an institute-wide elective. So there are multiple choices, and one of the modules that we encourage for our participants is the module on watershed and river basin management, so they can really have additional training in how hydrology and hydrological science is embedded and is really the foundation of so many of those management decisions. From there, preparations begin for the thesis phase. It includes preparatory courses on research techniques, technologies. There's a phase of summer courses that are often broadening courses that even teach some transferable skills, which I'll mention in a second. And then the taught program concludes with 3 weeks of group work where our hydrologists combine with participants from other programs to tackle a basin scale challenge and put together a master plan for addressing the challenges in that basin. And from there, you enter into the thesis phase, and there's 6 months of research with a mentor or two, supervised by a professor, either myself or, if it's more appropriate, if there are other expertise needed, there's the opportunity to be supervised by another professor in the program. Today, and this is also coming back to Stefan Uhlenbrock, who was mentioned before, we strive to produce what we refer to as T-shaped students. T-shaped students, and they're in the shape of a T because there is a vertical bar, and that vertical bar represents the depth of knowledge and understanding that they develop in hydrology itself, in the field technology, the field methodologies and monitoring, the modeling, the analysis of that data. This is the unique set of skills and knowledge that these graduates bring into the water sector and into the water community. But we also want them to enter that community with the knowledge of the horizontal bar in that team. And that includes knowledge of neighboring disciplines, of some of the social sciences, economics, the ecologists, that they will absolutely find themselves working with in teams. it's critical to have enough of a common knowledge or a knowledge of those neighboring disciplines so that you can cooperate and effectively and you can communicate effectively. And finally, I mentioned transferable skills before. We also want our participants to come out as trained professionals that can speak, that can write, that can critically evaluate the information that's coming to them, whether it's the reading a hydrological report or even being a good citizen and reading the latest news, which is challenging all of us more and more to critically review and find the authenticity in it. And a final point about the program is that in that research phase, and I think it has always been this way, but we place special effort on interacting, on linking our participant research activities to other organizations, whether they be governmental, the different water boards or regional water authorities of the Netherlands, they might be private companies, they might be other international organizations and the like, but hydrology is an applied science. We conduct research to understand the dynamics of the system in order to guide decision making and addressing pertinent management questions and challenges. So we try to team as early and as closely as possible with partners that help us to conduct more applied, more useful research. Research. I'm going to say a word about it. I'm already over time. This is primarily a celebration of our education program. So I wanted to spend the majority of the time there. But of course, education and research are very closely connected, right? Our educational program is fed by the experiences and the activities being carried out in our research program as well. So today in the program, we emphasize three lines of applied research. You'll see in the top in blue, a focus on near-surface hydrological processes. We say near-surface because it includes the surface, as well as the shallow subsurface, groundwater and aquifer systems. We don't focus very much on very deep systems. These are systems that are more actively interacting with the surface. These are data-rich studies that are about the occurrence and movement of these waters based on field data and the use of process-based models. We also have a line of research in ecohydrology, in ecohydrological processes, so looking at the interaction between the hydrological cycle and ecosystems, looking at the mutual dependencies of one on the other, the ways that the hydrological cycle drives the dynamics of ecosystems, and vice versa, how ecosystems and their dynamics can influence the water cycle. We're interested in understanding those from a scientific perspective, from a functioning perspective, and then translating what we learn into a services perspective, because it's at this interface of hydrology and ecology that many important ecosystem services are provided to society. And finally, we have a line that focuses on basin hydrology. These are larger studies, as it says, integrating both ground measurements as well as satellite measurements to understand larger dynamics, and especially translating this understanding into larger scale models and tools that can support directly decision making. What's the geography of our work? It's international, as you can expect. You'll see the purple triangles in different parts of the world. There's a strong concentration of work in Africa, which has been an area, a priority area from the institution from the beginning. And this is a selection of some of our current and very recent project activities. Of course, if we went back through the entire history of the program, I'm sure that much of the globe would be covered with activities. But I'm talking about where we are today. So this gives you a sense of where some of our priority activities are today. And then just to finish with an example here and there of these programs in this near-surface hydrological processes and studies, Jan Willem Volpen is leading a program called TGRU, which is looking at groundwater, surface water connections in peri-urban areas, often where slums occur, looking at those connections, looking at the transport of pathogens and other water quality related problems, and some fascinating work that crosses the line, again, between the science as well as the social sciences of what's going on, and even the distribution of power in these peri-urban areas, and how that influences both the occurrence of contamination and the ability of people living in these regions and attempting to manage these regions to deal with those issues. So I encourage you finding on Willem and asking him questions about this during the during our break later. There's a program that I'm responsible for, the Mau Mara Serengeti Sustainable Water Initiative in Kenya and Tanzania, where we're looking at this interface between hydrology and ecology in order to identify the minimal flow regime, the variability of flow throughout the year, and some of the short-term dynamics that are necessary to preserve a desired level of functionality of the ecosystems of this river. This is the river that drains the Masai Mara National Reserve, Serengeti National Park. It has a very high conservation value, but it also has a very high ecosystem service value to people living in the region because they depend directly in many ways on that river. So we're looking through our studies of how to provide the opportunity for the maximal use of water for other purposes in the basin, but ensuring that we maintain the flow regime in the river that will also sustain those ecosystems. And finally, some of our colleagues have partnered with the Niger Basin Authority and applying satellite-based, ground-based measurements and developing a system that combines that information into a tool that presents the information in a useful and coherent way, and of course can be used to guide and support the actions that they take. So that's a quick overview. Gives you a sense for where we are today. So now, sticking to our time schedule, because we are going to have more time later for discussion, let me invite Koop to the stage to broaden our perspective and share a bit with us about our neighbors. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michael. Well, in the program it says that I'm going to talk about hydrology education and research in the Netherlands. I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to talk about 50 years of international course for hydrologists. At least that was how it was founded. It was founded as the course for hydrologists. And I see some of the senior hydrologists in the room. I'm not going to run the risk that I have to mention everybody's name, but I'm going to mention a few. I see Henny Kolenbrander here. I think, Henny, you are, I would say, presently the grandfather of hydrology in the Netherlands. he was the Secretary General of the IHS, and I think for many, many years, the motor behind the hydrological organization in the Netherlands. I see Peter de Laat. He is the most senior person in this 50 years course for hydrologists, because I think you arrived 6 years after the foundation, so you must have been involved with the course for 44 years, assuming that you're still involved. And I see several other people that I will mention later, but Piet Warmerdam. Piet, it's great that you are here. Always the Wageningen connection also with this course. Reinder Boekeman, of course, TU Delft, also always a warm heart for IHE. And Theo Osthorn. And I'm not going to mention everybody because then I run the risk that I miss out. But I saw Jan Nonner just entering the room. Jan and I arrived here more or less at the same time. In fact, Jan a couple of months earlier. But it's really great. I cannot see all the faces, so if I miss somebody, please excuse me for not mentioning you. This is not a picture of 50 years ago, but we see Philip O'Kane, also one of the old hands here in the hydrology program. There are several more that I will show. This is a picture that I got out of my album at home. My wife, in fact, scanned it yesterday night. And this was when I was recently nominated professor here. Not in hydrology, but in water resources management, but as part of the hydrology program, because it was the branch C of the course for hydrologists. And of course, Mike Hall and Peter Lelaat and two of our graduates. I'm going back in history to 25 years ago. And our leader at the time was Bill Zeger. And I know that Peter Lelaat, you probably were the one, or maybe Shaheen, who said, we have to celebrate this 25 years and we have to make it big. And then we decided to make a book of it, and we had a big, big seminar where a lot of very, very famous hydrologists came. I will show you that later. But key people there were Peter Lelaat, Mamdouh Shaheen, of course, and three people that I mentioned here, Professor Volker, and Professor Verruyt and Professor Van Dam, who were in fact the first hydrology professors in this program, and they were awarded a special educational award during this ceremony. And I still remember very well of Professor Verruyt that he said that he was really happy with that. He said, yeah, it may not be something that is recognized internationally as a top hydrology award, but he said, I cherish this award. He was really happy with it. So that was a nice thing. And Jan, you remember, of course, we were in the temporary buildings in the Nieuwe Laan, and we had this great party. We had a very, very excellent set of presentations. And it was also the time that we were looking for the hydrology professor. It was more or less back to back. And out of that process, Mike Hall arrived as the first professor of hydrology.
Pardon? Hank Oging also.
Hank Oging, but it was later. That was not during this case. Now, this is the contents of this this booklet. And I'm going to draw your attention to a few names. Of course, Bill Zeger gave the opening address with an excellent speech. I don't know who made the speech. Not Bill Zeger himself, probably Peter and I had a hand in that. And then there was, of course, Solsinac, Andras, who was representing UNESCO there, John Rodda, representing WMO, Henny, you were there, yeah, and Hoogland of the ministry. And then we had a talk of Shaheen, who had documented. Shaheen was excellent at documenting everything. So he has, in this booklet, which is still must still be here in the library, he described the 25 years very much detail. And then Peter, of course, and then we see famous names. Eamon Nash. Yeah? Eamon Nash, and we see Jim Duke. These are two of the fathers of hydrology. I don't know how many people here in the room know Nash and Duke by name. Please raise your hands if you know them. I see half the room not raising their hands. This is a shame. This is a shame. Nash and Duke, the real fathers of hydrology. And these are the most famous people. Jim Duke. He passed away maybe three or four years ago. And 2000?
No,
6 years ago. And in his final year, he still wrote a paper in the journal Hess that at that moment I was executive editor of Hess, and I invited him to write the first open access paper. He did. And he still wrote with a lot of passion about his big ideas about hydrology, which is that hydrology, although extremely complex, manifests itself through sometimes surprisingly simple hydrological laws. And his idea was, how can we connect these simple laws with the complex physics that underlie it, and that is still, until today, one of the biggest questions in hydrology. And Eamon Nash, those of you who don't remember Nash, knowing of the Nash-Sutcliffe coefficient. By the way, Sutcliffe, I met a few years ago in Wallingford. He is still alive and kicking. But anyway, Nash and Duke. And I'm going to say more about Nash in a minute. And then, Verhout, I still remember Jan saying, this is, you just used the Dutch word, smullen. Yeah. This is delicious to listen to Verhout's talk. He gave a very nice talk. This case from the Akker, of course. I heard that case would be here. I don't see case, but hopefully he will come later. And there is Frank Rijsselman. And why was this? You see, surface water hydrology, nowadays we would say maybe near surface hydrology, surface water hydrology, groundwater hydrology, and water resources management. Because at this meeting, we decided to create the three specializations. Jan Lommer and Yang Xiao were behind the groundwater specialization, and I was behind the water resources management specialization, and I worked very closely with Frank Rijsselman to set up the contents of this course. And by the way, also Rob Koudstaal. And this was the first water resources management course in the world. And it's celebrating today its 25 years of existence. So we should be celebrating here 25 years of the course of water resources management as well. Which is still existing, but no longer part of hydrology, but part of the water management program. But that was the foundation. Yeah, there was this hydrology award, and it was awarded to Professor Mostertman, who is the founder of this institute, Professor Volker. Professor Volker, I personally have extremely warm memories of Professor Volker. He was the first hydrology professor here in this institute. He always called it the international course. At that time, I was studying, and Render was a student assistant at that time. I was studying at TU Delft and following the lectures of Volker. And Volker did his lectures always in English. And he used lecture notes that were the IHE lecture notes. And he always referred to it as the international course. And Professor Volker, please remember him. Never forget Professor Volker. He has created the international perspective on hydrology. He taught the hydrology of Myanmar, Burma, of Thailand, of Japan, other, mostly Asian, was very Asian focused, but he opened my perspective in international hydrology. And Professor Van Damme was my promoter, and Arnold Verhout, who I dare say is the best lecturer ever. And I don't want to. No, they are not there. This is just the background. And there are a few people there. We see, of course, Patrick Denny. We see Bella Petri. We see Mike Hall. We see Wim van Viersen. We see Zegeren. We see Jan. Jan. Okay. We see myself and Maarten Blokland. Yeah. Okay, now, going back to this 1991 celebration that we had, and the establishment of this three specializations course, this was all in context. We were not responding to the international developments. We were part, and with we, I say IHE, we were part of setting the international agenda. In 1991, we had the International Conference on a Strategy for Water Resource Capacity Building, which Gialat was the main driver of. Then we had the launch of the Branch C, and we were at that time writing Rob Koudstaal, Frank Rijsselman, and myself, who defined the Branch C course, the Water Resource Management, we were writing the background document for the Rio de Janeiro conference. So the water part of the Rio de Janeiro conference was written by us, IHE. Huh? And that was input directly into the conference of the International Conference on Environment and Development. So we were, and still are, the institute is part of the international context. Now, this is from these little booklets that we have. We call them a smaller book, if you remember. And this is the course of 1991, the first ABC branches. And let me point out a few people. Hey, there's Nero! Nero! You were the first one.
Yeah.
And you're going to speak today because you have been 25 years now with the Institute. And either Andrea, I thought you were also there, but Andrea, you know, you were.
Later.
It was later.
Younger.
Nero was the first one. And there are a few famous people here. Liu Heng, he's I think, the most important Chinese hydrologist at this moment. He's also the IHP representing China. And here is Michael Mutale, who got the Alumnus Award a couple of years ago of IHE.
You're stealing my lines.
Huh?
You're stealing my lines.
Yeah. So that was very nice, I think. Now I'm going back to Nash, because in that booklet, Nash gave a speech about his vision on hydrological education. Exactly what is asked from us now, Nash did 25 years ago. And what he did 25 years ago is still extremely valid and relevant today. First of all, he said, or he asked the question, is hydrology an earth science or an engineering specialization? Because at that time, in the 60s, when hydrology was defined, hydrology was seen as a specialization of hydraulic engineering. In fact, hydrology in the International Hydrological Decade, and which where Volker was one of the founding members there, Volker himself thought, yeah, but isn't hydrology, in fact, a hydraulic engineering specialization?
Is it a science?
Yeah. Isn't it that? Or should it be seen as a science? And this is still today a big question, because science, when you talk about science, people think of elementary processes, the laws of Newton. But these are applied to molecules, or even at a smaller scale, they go back to atoms, or they go even at subatom. That is physics. If you ask somebody what is physics or what is science, then that's what they're talking about. But hydrology is not at that scale. Hydrology is at a system scale, or at least at an aggregate scale, where, of course, the laws of Newton still apply, but the relationship, the closure relations that we see, are different from the closure relations that you would get in the lab, because the system scale is organized. Well, this is not what Nash was saying, but this is what I say. The system scale is organized by living organisms. It is the ecosystem that in fact shapes the hydrological behavior. The ecosystem manipulates the near surface environment in a way that they maximize their survival. And the hydrological performance that we see at system scale is in fact a manipulated system, not by us, we also do it as people, but by the ecosystem, in a way that there is some optimality. And optimality leads to predictable performance. And this is why the system scale is important. And that is closer to the thinking of engineers. Engineers also think at system scale. So I think this is where the dichotomy comes from. But I see it as an earth science, but as Michael said, an applied science, in the sense that it applies to a larger system scale. But this was also what Nash was talking about. So, is it science or is it technology? A lot of people nowadays, with the advances in technology, they concentrate on the technology. Some hydrologists sit behind the computer their entire life and hardly go into the field. And the technology can become so dominant that you start to believe your models more than the data. If the model doesn't do what the data do, then they say, well, I don't trust the data. Data is very unreliable. Don't let data spoil your perfect model. But it is a science. It is a science. It is an applied science. And this is what Nash said. It's an applied science that involves, and very importantly, creativity. Creativity, these are his words. Imagination and intelligence. Yeah, you're coming to my point. Creativity, imagination, intelligence. We are not just, even if you are a modeler, you do that with creativity, imagination, intelligence. Very important to identify and formulate the problem. That means at the right scale of where you are. To formulate and test hypotheses. And to identify solutions, because there comes the engineering part. We are not just earth scientists, we are, as hydrologists, also looking at possible solutions. And this is what, these are the words of Nash. He said, this cannot be done by mathematicians, statisticians, and physicists. And he was an emotional man, like me. I've seen him getting extremely angry with people who approach hydrology purely as a statistical or mathematical science. He would get very angry, very emotional. A nice person, a warm body. I liked him a lot. And this is what he said. Finally, assembling relevant scientific principles and tools of analysis and applying these in the appropriate context. Here we come to the context. That was your final point also, Michael. It's all in context. And there is a societal context. And important. And this is a paper I wrote myself, and I must say, I had forgotten that Nash mentioned this creativity, because this is about the art of hydrology, and this is where I say exactly what Nash was saying. We need imagination, inspiration, creativity, ingenuity, and experience and skill. And I must have listened by to Nash. You never think if you, you never know if you get your ideas from inside or from outside. I mean, I'm quite convinced that all science is done by interacting with other people. And when you have a new idea, it's seldom a new idea. It's something that you picked up from the ether. But anyway, I fully agree with Nash on that hydrology is as much an art as it is a science and a technology. What Nash said also, he said, is that through observation, which is empirical, we have to derive laws that apply to the system scale. And in this respect, he completely agreed with Duke. We have to observe, recognize patterns, recognize system behavior, which is often more simple than, you could also say, by reductionism, by trying to build up hydrology from the most fundamental point mass analysis, you cannot get hydrological performance. You can only get hydrological performance when you have patterns that in these processes, that or patterns that emerge at the system scale. Hypothesis formulation, testing, and modification, very scientific approach. Difference with basic science lies in the scale of the application. So he said, fundamental science works at the smaller scale, but hydrology at an aggregate scale. And that's the difference. That's the difference. Hydrology is an earth science, but at aggregate scales. So we study the catchment rather than the particle. And he said there are two pillars, scale and context. And these are still the issues of today. Now I will aggregate it a bit more into my own idea, but it's very much built on what Nash said. Hydrological education requires four things. Yeah? Basic sciences, really basic science. We should be good at mathematics and physics, hydraulics, ecology, and geology. These are fundamental things that all hydrologists should at least have basic knowledge about. And with fundamental, I mean that you do not just have a scratch the surface knowledge, but that you really know about fundamentals. Then, of course, we have to use analytical tools, and statistics and modeling are part of it. We cannot do hydrology nowadays without using computer models. But they are tools. They are tools. They are not the objective of what we do. Yeah, and empiricism, without fieldwork, you will never be able to understand exactly how the system works. And without field knowledge, you will never become creative and never understand how hydrology works. So field work and comparative hydrology, comparing between different landscapes, between different regions, between different climates is extremely important. And finally, context. So Michael, I think we fully agree on that. You really have to understand the context, but also have an understanding of the processes that are taking place in the societal context. And then, for me, it's extremely important that we think at the scale of systems. Because at systems, there is emergent behavior. And if you don't see that, if you use what some people call physically based distributed models, and you think that that is how the world functions, you are mistaken. Because then you miss the essential characteristics that patterns, that as a result of patterns, emerge in landscapes and at various scales. Even at the scale of a soil, without preferential infiltration, you will not understand how soils function. And I personally don't think that we should split hydrology into these subdisciplines. In the past, it was surface hydrology, groundwater hydrology. I think that is nowadays no longer acceptable. And I was happy to see, Michael, that you talked about near-surface hydrology, where geohydrology and rainfall runoff and interaction with the atmosphere and interaction with the vegetation are all part of the same thing. And if we split it up too much, we miss essential characteristics of the hydrological system. So I'm not for splitting it up into subdisciplines. It should be integrated. And there are many hydrological laws that appear at the system scale. Linear reservoir behavior of watersheds. There are many people who say that it is not linear, but then you don't look at the appropriate scale. If you look at the appropriate scale, groundwater depletion is exponential, and that is the same as a linear reservoir in all organized catchments. If you only look at one hill slope, you may see nonlinear behavior. If you go further down a river basin, you will see a nonlinear behavior because the Saint-Venance equations are nonlinear. But when you look at the catchment scale, which has the same structure as the leaf of a plant, you'll see linear behavior. Just like in your body. If every time my heart beats, all the tissue in my body receives oxygen at the same rate and at the same resistance. If not, I would have a dead finger or something in my brain would go amiss. So every living organism is organized in a way that the resistance to the source of the moisture is the same. In the plants, the stomata have the same resistance to the water that feeds them, and this is also in hydrological systems the case. It's all natural systems. If we don't recognize that, we make an important mistake. And there are many of these emergent behaviors, like the Buddhico curve, ecosystems as an active agent, optimizing the conditions for survival. There are the two water worlds. I don't know if you are familiar with it. Jeff McDonnell, one of my great examples in hydrology, identified that groundwater often has, or in most parts of the world, groundwater has the same isotopic signature as the rainfall. That means that it has not been in contact with the topsoil where evaporation takes place. That means that groundwater recharge, at least in most parts of the world, there are exceptions, is recharged directly after the root zone has been satisfied. So the first moisture is sucked into the root zone, and once that is saturated, it goes preferentially down without mixing. This is two separate water worlds. It goes completely against all handbooks of hydrology that we know, which see groundwater recharge as recharge that goes through the root zone. It doesn't go through the root zone, it passes by the root zone. And this is just an example of how different things are organized. And in fact, this is for the ecosystem the best, because it has two conditions for survival. It needs enough moisture, but it also needs drainage. And drainage you do by bypassing the water. This is also what engineers do. We don't drain the rain from our roof through the house. We bypass it. That is the logical engineering way to do it. This is also what ecosystems do. They are like us. Okay, so finally, hydrological education requires three things: science, technology, and art. That's my closing statement. And I would like to close off also with a picture of Mike Hall and myself with the Prince of Orange, Bert Diphorn on the left, and you see on the right still the smiling face, the proud face of Wil Zeger. And I think behind the back of the present king you see Wim van Viersen. And this was my closing slide.
Thank you. Thank you so much. A stimulating, provocative, fascinating talk. It had little to do with what we asked you to speak about, but I'm glad you chose to follow your heart. We'll see. Took a little bit of Nino's content, a little bit of the history, but now it's really a pleasure to invite Yang Xiao to the stage to queue up. But I'm losing my order. Yes, you are. You are now. So the floor is yours.
Dear guests, dear colleagues, and dear participants, welcome to celebrate the 50 years of Hydrology Course, but also my 25th anniversary of working at IHE. It's amazing, isn't it? So I'm 25 years younger than Hydrology Course. That's true. I prepared to give a talk about two parts. By the way, these are the people celebrating the 25th anniversary, but also today celebrating 50th anniversary of Hydrology Course. There are other few people also did the same, Yalanda, for example. So my talk is two part. I think you did most of already about my first part of the talk. I cannot skip my slides, but I will go faster. And the second part of my talk is the reflection of my work at IHE in last 25 years. I will quickly go through some slides so you can see there are some photos. Information about the first director of IHE, Professor Mossman. Yeah. He established the International Course for Hydrologists in 1966. So you see in the photo, he was with the students in the field visit. In the 25 years from 1966 to 1991, we have a lot of students, so all average about 26, but the most courses were given by guest lectures. There are a few guest lectures sitting in this room today. There were only three IHE staff members. You see the name, Peter Dillard, Dr. Shahi, and Wim Sparks. They were running the hydrology course. So if we calculate, the ratio between the participants and the staff is the highest in those days. Professor Wil Zeger, you mentioned already, he's the second director of IHE, and he started the Master of Science Education at IHE, yeah. I think in 1986. So 2 years after, we had the first Master of Science graduation from Indonesia, that's Mrs. Adi Dama. In 1989, we had three Master of Science graduations. One of them is Bob Su, the small one here, But you will see him today. He's a wonderful panel member. You permission already that we had a big celebration of 25th anniversary of Hydrology Course. One of the main owners, Yanoida, he's sitting here. You see, he's chair a seminar, and Professor Pratt will give a presentation. And you didn't have the photos I have here, so you can see. The climax of celebration is the IHE Hydrology Education Awards to Professor Mosema, Professor Badam, Professor Volker, and Professor Farad. Around the year 1991 and 1992, hydrology section was established. We had seven staff members. Mark Ho became the first full-time professor of hydrology in 1992. You permission already. And the name of the international course for hydrologists changed to Master of Science program in Hydrology, consists of three specializations: surface water hydrology, groundwater hydrology, and water resources management. You've already mentioned that in 1995, the water resources management separated from Hydrology course. They merged with water quality management, created a new program called WORM. You see from the number of students, in 1995 we had a significant drop of participants because this split. But fortunately, in the coming years, the number of participants increased largely due to the contribution from China group training programs. I will give you more information later. In 2003, IHE became UNESCO-IHE. The hydrology master course of hydrology also changed to a specialization in water science and the engineering program. In 2005, Stephen Woodenbrook became the second professor of hydrology. His name is mentioned already. At the next time, now we have a large core of hydrology, around 10 staff. So that's one of the largest groups at the institute. The PhD program started in 1992, I think, in the institute, but only in 1999, we had the first promotion of a PhD degree in hydrology program. So that's Nano Cookridge. His name I mentioned already several times. Only after a few years, the number of PhD students really increased, also the number of publications. One of the important programs is Erasmus Models program. Mark already mentioned already, so we have a new energetic staff member, Dr. Tibor Stichter. He took the lead to develop this program. The reason is that we have suffered from a low number of participants in the last decades. Personally, I think it's because of the competition of the universities for the same amount of resident fellowship program. But we have this new joint program with the University of Lisbon in Portugal and the Technical University of Dresden in Germany. Last year we had 14 participants, and this year we have 20 participants. This picture shows the one of field visits. The participants of applied groundwater modeling course. You see there are so many participants because it's the regular participants plus the Erasmus modules participants and the short course participants. This is the current situation. So you see this portrait from Mark's presentation. So I put here three layers of stuff: groundwater, surface water, and ecosystem. So the group is really heterogeneous and anisotropic. So that's the hydrogeology term. You see also the Marco Macley became the professor of eco-hydrology in 2012, and he's now the chair of the group. So that's the first part. Now I come to the second part. I would like to review my 25 years education, research, and project at IHE. Never give some personal remarks and conclude my talk with some acknowledgement. 25 years education. I firmly believe in Confucian's education principle. We also have some people to cite from China. Some examples, no student left behind. Tailored teach for individual learner. Learning without thinking loses direction. Thinking without learning is a waste of time. Review the old while learning the new. To study never feels boring. To teach never feels tired. Especially like one with me and I have been teaching for 25 years. A sensitive learner must not feel ashamed for asking questions, learn from each other when in a group. I hear, I forget, I see, and I remember, and do and understand. I was also inspired by two distinguished professors to be a passionate teacher. So the first one is Professor Li Junqing. He's my teacher at the university in China, still my mentor up to today. Another professor is Professor Frat. I was sitting in his class at IHE. He demonstrated that how you can teach a complex subject with a very clear, simple examples. So here you see he received the IHE Education Award. So myself, education in 25 years. I have been teaching 4 courses. I supervised a large number of MC students. I participated in developing and implementing master program abroad. And also developed and implemented group training programs for the Ministry of Water Resources of China. I have teaching these 4 courses for many years. So I believe good IHE education tradition, we wrote our own lecture notes. So that's my 4 lecture notes. One of the courses I have done together with Dr. Osik, I don't know whether he's here today, for applied groundwater modeling. So this course is organized as a regular short course at IHE, and it's also offered as a tailor-made short courses in many countries. It's attract a large number of participants. So it's one of the successful courses I have done. Supervision of master of students. So I have a philosophy that every student should do their utmost to achieve the best results. So for the strong participants, they are encouraged to develop their full potential and to achieve the best results. For relatively weaker participants, they are supported to achieve the results which satisfy the minimum requirements for a Master of Science degree. So here I mention 2 names, Nato Kukerich and Adrian Janowski. They both received Master of Science degree with a distinction. I had a really pleasure to work with them. We respect each other as equal professionals, not just a supervisor student relationship. You will hear their story very soon. The International Education Development Project, one of the top projects is Sana University Support Project. Yanoi Dag was the project director. from 1993 to 2004, IHE staff members working in Sana'a University in Yemen as the residence team leader. So we succeeded in 1995 to launch the first Master of Science program in Water and Environmental Engineering. The most successful education program, I think, is the China Group Training Programs. From 1996 to 2008, we organized 10 group training programs for the Ministry of Water Resources and the River Basin Commissions. About 150 professionals came to IHE and trained with a Master of Engineering or Master of Science degree. All these training programs were financed by the Netherlands government. So those are the people who contributed to this training program. This picture shows some group training program participants. I would like also to show, the king of the Netherlands, but not at that time, it's the prince, crown prince of Netherlands. In 2005, we organized a seminar for former IHE alumni during the second International Year in the River Forum. The prince and the Netherlands ambassador to China, it's Mr. Fordenberg. I think you recognized him. He's now also the chairman of IHE Foundation Board. They attended this seminar. 25 years research. I recognized that research is very important for my career development. Although IHE has limited research facilities, I did my best to pursue some researches in these three areas of my interest in. The groundwater monitoring and modeling, groundwater sustainability, groundwater surface water interactions, and vegetation dependency. Groundwater monitoring and modeling. So we know groundwater is a hidden resource. So we must use monitoring and modeling tools to acquire information for the assessment of groundwater quantity and quality. However, monitoring is very expensive and the modeling contains very large uncertainties. So the best methods to integrate modeling and monitoring tools to produce sufficient information with adequate reliability and lowest costs. Groundwater is a renewable but limited resources. Overexploitation of groundwater resources worldwide has caused many environmental problems. For example, the groundwater depletion, net subsidence, saltwater intrusion, and the degradation of groundwater-dependent ecosystems. So therefore, we have to use groundwater resources for socio-economic development, but at the same time to protect the environment. There is still a long way for us to go to achieve sustainable groundwater resources development. Groundwater is not an isolated resource. Interactions between groundwater and surface water, between groundwater and the dependent ecosystem takes place almost everywhere. Quantifications of groundwater-surface water interactions allows us to plan and use the groundwater-surface water as a single resources. Quantification of groundwater dependency by vegetation allows us to leave some water for ecosystem use, especially in arid and semi-arid areas. So nowadays, the research output is measured by a very simple CP index. I'm sure here also two indexes, one is Google Scholar and another is ResearchGate. This number is not great, but I still have about 10 years to improve before my retirement. 25 years project. So this paper is five large projects I did. It's not a surprise you see that all projects taking place in China. A lot of Chinese and Dutch partners participated in these five projects. The projects are financed by Netherlands and Chinese government. So these are the projects that take place from 2000 to 2016. The first project is groundwater development in northwest of China from 2000 to 2002. The major outputs of the project, we have trained five researchers, we trained 12 trainers, we trained a large number of professionals from northwest of China, and we compiled five lecture notes and published a book. I think in this room, Bob Su, Yanoner, I don't know whether Jasper, Hrufiukin, they were also participating in this project. Through this project, we established very good cooperations with the China Geological Survey and China University of Geoscience. The second project is Nantou River Basin Management. Nantou River is a Chinese name. Internationally, you call Upper Mekong River. It's about soil, water, and ecosystem conservation. So I just show these two pictures. These two photos were taken in the same day after rain. So the upper photo you see, the river water is very clean. And the lower photo you see, the river water is very turbulent. So this is a clear indication how good is the soil and the water management in the catchment. This is a large project, groundwater, China Groundwater Information Center project we did from 2003 to 2008 together with the TNO people. The major output of the project, we have installed 100 automatic recorders to monitor groundwater level. And we constructed the four databases and information systems. We trained a large number of professionals, published many papers and a book. We systematically conducted groundwater system characterization, groundwater monitoring, database information system development, construction of regional groundwater flow models, and formulation of sustainable groundwater development scenarios. So we trained the Chinese project member first, then we called them to carry out project activities, and we organized seminars to disseminate project results. This is one of the example of monitoring of groundwater level. From this monitor data, we can see there is a rapid decrease of groundwater levels from 1999 to 2000, a total drop of 40 meters in 11 years. In the picture, you see Frost here, young owner, so they're also in the room today. They were involved in this project. As a spin-off of this project, Chinese government now is implementing a national groundwater monitoring project. So they are going to install 20,000 observation wells. Eco-hydrology research in Erdos Plateau, that's in China, it's from 2009 and 2012. This is a very productive research project. The major outputs from this project, we have trained researchers, we set up a research catchment, we measured the river discharge, groundwater, water used by plants and crops, and published a lot of papers. We constructed a well in 2011, so in the picture you see Yao Heng, he's involved in this project. from the measurements of groundwater and the river discharge, the conclusion that 90% of river discharge comes from groundwater seepage. So what do you see now? The picture this year, the river was flushed away by a big floods in August 15 this year. So Yahoo made the first time to see this picture. We also measured the water use by trees and by bushes, and the conclusion that the vegetation depends largely on groundwater for transpiration. So you mentioned about bypass recharge, but the plants can also take groundwater for evaporation, transpiration. This is a project we just finished this year, so together with the water lab, Teo sit here today, he's a key member in this project. This is the first engineering project I did in my life. We constructed a multifunctional wetland park in a small city, the Delft city in southwest of China. So in the park, we constructed water intake from the river, dosage system, coagulation ponds, sedimentation basin, sludge treatment plant, constructed the wetlands, infiltration basins for groundwater recharge, abstraction wells for pumping groundwater for urban water supply, monitor wells, and also a visit center for public education. So this photo, the upper left photo shows the construct of the wetlands, and the right photo shows the two infiltration bases for groundwater recharge. The park is opened officially September 23 this year. So you see here, this is the deputy mayor of Delft City, and this is the council general of Netherlands. So my wife saw the photo and said, oh, that's my student. He studied the Chinese, so it's a small world. Now some remarks. Education is the foundation of existence of UNESCO-IHE, or maybe we call IHE very soon. The institute could do better in recognizing the great contributions of those who devoted their entire career to the education of thousands of participants. Research is very important for an academic institute. It contributes to the education of PhD students and upgrading the education program. The institute should allocate necessary time to staff for produce scientific publications. We cannot just write papers during the weekends. Project raises 1/3 of income to the institute. The management of the institute should feel responsible and take lead in the project acquisition. I think Marco is one of the best examples in this aspect. Chair group and the backing board of the institute. The institute will do well as long as the chair groups perform well. However, we must recognize there is a need of a capacity building of our own chair group. Also, IHE is called a capacity building institute. Acknowledgements. First, IHE. I value the international education program. I enjoyed my work as a teacher and research in the last 25 years. To my family, my wife and my two daughters, they are my motto to keep me going strong. I'm in particular grateful to my wife as she sacrificed her career and take care of us. To our participants, I feel great satisfaction when I see their career development and growth after I finish a study here. So wherever I'm in a short mission or conference visit, I meet many of our IHE alumni. So that's really a great pleasure. To all colleagues for cooperation and support, and to Dutch and Chinese governments for financial support of all my project activities. Thank you all for your attention.
Thank you very much. Wise words. Wonderful. Let's continue. We've been talking about Neno this whole time. So now the opportunity is one of the alumni of the program that we would like to hear from. Neno, please join us. And then, Andrea, you will also have the opportunity to share your thoughts as well afterwards.
Thank you.
No, I will not find myself. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It's really a pleasure and for me to be here because it's a special occasion. When the young child approached me and asked me, well, that's the appropriate picture to put it on. Yes, indeed. When the young child approached me and asked me, would I like to say a few words? I couldn't refuse because I owe that also to my fellow participants 25 years ago, this very special year, 25 years ago, we were talking about. And I'm the only one here who is invited and who is not in education, who is not a lecturer, and to say something, and who is not. Professor, well, I remain very much in a field of water, more specific groundwater, but I was participant at this course 25 years ago, and I want to share with you just a few memories about these great years. Yesterday, going through the corridor, I bumped to Andrea, who was standing with Arthur Manette, emeritus professor of UNESCO-IHE, you also know. And I was shouting to Andrea, I'm not going to make any presentation for tomorrow, these slides or something like that. Well, I found a couple of photos from that time, but you know, that very compromising photos, me having parties all the time and drunk, etc. And Arthur commented, well, bring those, you know, we remember you like that. Well, I hope not. But that was a great time. And I remember when I came here in 91, this building was not here. Young smiling, he was the big boss at that time. We were in a temporary location. And first I came across Peter Delft, because Peter was the hydrology man. He was the course leader, and he was a father, mother, everything else to us. We came here. And well, I saw this gentleman, I approached, I waited for my time, I sat in front of him, and he asked me where I was coming from, and I told him the country, I asked. And then he asked where, and I told him a place, a small place in the middle of nowhere, and he said, oh, I know a place, I was there. And it was great to, you know, to have this first contact with made between where I was coming from and this unknown world for me. And then second contact was with Yang Xiao, a Chinese guy coming to, at that time we didn't have PowerPoints, coming with a lot of overheads. And luckily we had overheads, otherwise I couldn't follow him at all at the time. And the third guy was a slim guy like myself, and talking a lot and gesticulating. He's still doing that, he just did it. And started to talk something about integrated water resources management, something new. No. And he was very excited about that new concept. And he finished, and I asked him, okay, that's nice, but where is groundwater? And I think we continued that joke for coming 25 years. But I told you just a young honor, of course, young is here. And I'm so glad to see you after so many years. When I said to Hoop, you're still in my lines, because I also wanted to mention a couple of people. And one of them is really Adam Ferreira, the best lecturer I ever had. And about this, we are talking about course of hydrology, so it's very easy for me to go outside of the course and to describe all these my impressions of coming here and being with a part of the course. But about course itself, I was part of groundwater, and we had a lot of short courses. And at that time, I experienced those courses as quite broad, maybe a little bit shallow, and I was waiting all the time to go more in depth. Later on, it took me some time to realize that actually this course provided a perfect background for many topics I had to address later on. So some of those handouts I used for years and years later if I had to address one or the other subject. I can't stand here and not mention some of my fellow participants in the course, like Muna from Sudan, Mugay, Jahid, Chakravorty from India, and Michael was in hydrology, but we accepted him somehow in groundwater group as well. And well, after finishing the course, I even did a PhD here, and someone told me that I was the first hydrology PhD student. And I did it with Tom and Marike at that time, and here comes someone who we miss, and Michael, because he was my promoter, and we did it together with the young show. Well, to round up, Hoop said it in his way, Yang Shao said it in his way, and I will not be very original, but this is really the core of my remembrance about course, and that is people. People I did course with, I learned a lot from professors, fellow participants, and continuing this field and for 25 years longer, and being in more than 70, 80 countries, working all over the world, and meeting UNESCO-IHE alumni all over the world. It's something which is here, and it's a special feeling. So, thanks.
Andrea, may I welcome you immediately to the next.
Good afternoon, everybody, and a special welcome to our guests, who are coming from outside of IHE. I will use slides. I will not be like Nemo. I need this support. And I will talk about my experience of learning hydrology here at IHE, and I will link it with some quotes from this another article of another famous hydrologist, Witt Klemisch. He wrote this article in 1988. All senior hydrologists would know the article and would know maybe the quotes. Sorry about that. But for young hydrologists, I recommend it. It's very educational and very entertaining. His quotes will be in blue, so you will recognize what he says and what I say. So I came in 94, civil engineer coming here at IHE to study hydrology. I was completely confused. And my view on hydrology when I came here was like the joke of Klemisch. He asked this question, is it true that hydrologists are scientists who study the relationship between the water cycle? And the answer was, in principle, yes, but they are not scientists. They are technologists, and they don't study them, they fudge them. So that was a joke, which of course reflected a little bit the truth. And I couldn't express it at that time in these words. I was not reading scientific papers. But that was my view on hydrology. I was educated as a civil engineer. In civil engineering, which was the discipline where most of hydrology was being taught and learned, this was an auxiliary toolbox that helps for our civil engineering design. And that was the impression that I had. So when I came here, I did this course, Master of Science of Groundwater Hydrology. I was also in Branch B. I learned some new things. First is that hydrology can include serious science, partial differential equations, mathematical models, and things like that. And everybody who spoke nearly mentioned Arnold Ferreira. I have to mention him again. And I fully agree that he was the best lecturer ever. And the designers of the course had this clever trick to put him in the very beginning of the course. So you would be mesmerized with the teaching of Ferreira. You would expect the same level throughout the course, but it was not like that. Methodology matters, something that I didn't know before coming at IHE, except for the evening news and the weather forecast, okay? First, climate change. Weighted water vapor as greenhouse gas, first words came to me from Peter Dalat in the hydrology course. Later on, we had my meteorology courses, and I learned quite a lot. So that was an important discovery. Now, civil engineers are very low in the ladder of respectability of science and engineering even disciplines. But we managed to look down on geologists and geographers and others. However, this is something that I learned here, that we can learn so much from hydrogeologists. And I have to mention Jan Nonner here and Yang Chao, who was my MSc supervisor. I'm still glad that he's around, that I can continue learning from him. This is a message coming from Hugh. Well, I was following one of the first lectures when he was talking about recycling of moisture in the atmosphere over Africa and how that evapotranspiration is not lost water, it's brought somewhere else where it's a valuable resource. Now, today it's so obvious, but I can tell you, for us at that time, for me in particular, it was a revelation in a way. There is another thing, Hugh, that maybe you don't remember. One of the first classes you were teaching us about difficulties in the Netherlands with pollution of groundwater that comes from farmers spreading manure over the fields. Now, my English was not bad, but I didn't know what manure is. Raise my hand. Excuse me. Can you tell me what this word means? And the whole class turned towards me. Some scared, some like, what is he trying to do? To put the professor on the spot? And Hugh was a little bit like this, Like this. He used the S word.
Yeah.
Not sustainable sanitation, but you know what I mean. And now I can tell you it was not my intention to put you on the spot. I really didn't know the word. Maybe the small incident that I remember, maybe you don't remember. Anyhow, that was a transition for many hydrology students, and I think at that time also for the hydrology as a field, and it was this transition of which Hugh already spoke about. So engineering hydrology, which is what I was acquainted with as a technology, towards hydrology as a science. Now, I work in hydroinformatics for many years, and I have to say a few words about the computers at IHE at that time. Not all staff members had computers. I think many academic staff members did not have computers. Most of the supporting staff did not have computers. Okay? For students, there were some reserved computer labs for computer exercises, but very soon they were not enough. What do I mean? Towards the end of my studies in 96, when we had to finalize the MSc research, everybody wanted to type their MSc thesis on a computer. There was only one computer room for MSc students. Lack of computers. I remember students queuing in front of the building at 7 o'clock in the morning so they would race to the computer room to catch a computer and they can write their thesis. That was in my generation. And then software. We used Lotus 1-2-3 for the workshop in hydrology. We were typing in WorkPerfect. Okay? And we even prepared presentation in WorkPerfect presentation. This MS Office came towards the end of the course. What about teaching with computers? Well, Jan, maybe you will recall this. Can anyone see something here?
Yes.
These were computer outputs of Resit 32, the software for interpreting electrical resistivity measurements. So we got the computer outputs, and in the exercise we had to draw the hydrological profile by hand. So that red mark there is your mark, Jan. You take that as a good presentation of the profile. Groundwater modeling exercise. This was within spans. So the output of the computer program was such that you would see only lines and dots, but the rivers and the wells, you have to draw yourself by hand. So you see how this is a mix of hand and computer output. Also in the results, the same story. So that works with computers. I want to say a few words about these challenges that Hugh was talking about and go back to the paper of Klemsch. So here we are, hydrology is somewhere in between technology and science. Now on this side we have this call that hydrologists would help many people. They have to help many people. For example, in his paper he says that hydrologists need to have biological and social skills, that they have to have the responsibility to work with health authorities to fight waterborne diseases. And even he talks about the role of the reconciliation of many conflicts. Yes? And you see what he thinks, that it's a role that would be very similar to the role of a land surveyor in a reconciliation of the conflicting territorial claims over Jerusalem.
Yeah, so it's not,
It's not very easy. So if you think of all these biologists, ecologists, maybe medical doctors, diplomats, who ask for the support of hydrologists, then we need this. We need hydrologists as superheroes. It's very difficult. On the other side, this is again from the paper of Klemsch. This is a quote that the business of hydrology is to solve the water balance equation. It's not his statement, it's a statement of Jim Duke that he quotes in that paper. And then you see what I underline here is the emphasis, what a true scientist writes, okay? Is the water balance equation exciting in all its dynamics? I mean, only a true scientist would be excited by an equation and talks about metamorphosis of one state of water into another. This is beautiful, Okay? But there is a problem here that we may end up like this. This is a caricature that some of you have maybe seen of scientists sitting in the ivory towers and telling that other people should solve the problems of the world. So Klemesh put this in a very nice way, explaining what happens to the hydrologist. This is our poor hydrologist, and this is a statement from this paper. Suspended between a technology that he does not practice and a science for which he has not been trained, this is our hydrologist. On a wire of techniques connecting the two distant poles and holding him in a place. Seeing the long distance separating from both of them, he clings to the wire, and now, what does he do? He does this. Before long, he becomes an expert in random number generation, non-parametric optimization of parameters, etc., etc. Especially like this one, non-parametric optimization of parameters. Okay? Now we have computers, so these kind of things can be superbly done. Okay. Now for those hydrologists who have the wrong idea that this is what hydroinformatics is about,
yeah.
It's not about that. But that's another story. So what is the role of hydrological education? It's actually to elevate these poor hydrologists, to tie the knot between these two poles so that maybe these hydrologists can walk one direction or the other, even if it is very difficult. And Klemmer said that, okay, at that time, 1988, there was a lack of science in hydrology. So we have to grow hydrology from the sciences. Techniques have to come later. After that, this was repeated by Hugh as well. And if I think, largely we have done this, especially here at this institute with the course on hydrology. And I'm happy about that. Maybe we are even swinging a bit too much on the science side, I would say, because these superheroes also need some support in their work, but maybe we are not giving enough of that. Klemmer said also something else about research, and here I'm also emphasizing. He said in 1988 that the present trend must be changed from emphasis on quantity to emphasis on quality regarding hydrological publications. Here, I'm not agreeing that we are there. I think there is this big push for the whole academia to go with quantity, and I don't know how to solve that problem, but I think that there is still some work to be done there. But if you think that things are bad, that doesn't mean that they cannot become worse. We can still take this other direction. So, soon, for our academic progress, we will not be asked about papers at all. But about the number of our Facebook friends. Thank you very much. This is my name. Thank you.
Wonderful, Andrea. Neno, thank you so much for those recollections, your perspective. Yang Shao as well. Thank you for your wise words, for sharing the wisdom that comes from 25 years embedded in the program and working every day to see it succeed. So we've spent our time so far reflecting on where we are, reflecting on where we've been, and I hope that you've found it stimulating. I found the presentation so thought-provoking as well. It's fascinating to hear through the experiences of the people who were there that the growth of the program in hydrology here at UNESCO-IHE and IHE Delft has gone hand in hand really with the development and the growth of hydrology as a science itself. Some of these phases of transition from being a technology into a science that's integrated with other sciences and seeking together to achieve solutions to some of the the biggest challenges we face. You know, that has all come together in these past decades. And this program has been an active participant, and these people have been an active participant in that process. So I was also a bit intimidated by the discussion of the outputs of the 25-year celebration of this program. It was clearly a big event that involved bringing in additional participants and the like. We have a more modest gathering today, but very much a gathering of a family, right? Because this is very much about the people who have been involved in this program for many years and who remain involved today. We're so happy to be able to welcome back those who were involved in past years but haven't been involved recently to bring those perspectives into the next discussion we're going to have, which is a discussion about the future. And we also have some folks joining us online via a live streaming event, and thank you for your emails, and a reminder to you that it is possible, in case you joined late, to join us to make a comment, to ask a question, and you can do that by sending an email to the email address ihehydrology50@gmail.com. Is that what I put on the screen in the beginning?
Yeah.
All lowercase, strung together, one word, ihehydrology50@gmail.com. So please feel free to send additional questions or comments. Okay, thank you for sticking with us through this time. What I'd like to do now as we enter into the final phase of the symposium is to invite our panel members to the stage. We've got some chairs here for you. So come on up, guys. It's Hoop, it's Mark, it's Remco, and it's Bob. I expect as well that many of you have already, you know, have questions or points that have arisen in the presentations so far. During this part of the symposium, we're going to have an opportunity for questions and discussion. So if there is a question that you have that refers back to an earlier presentation, when we begin the discussion period, feel free to ask those as well. It's going to be an open discussion among all of us. All right. Yes?
Mark will be here in a minute.
Oh, Mark has stepped out. we caught him right at the right time.
Just an emergency call.
Well, we don't have an official order to this that's been arranged ahead of time. You know, perhaps we should just present in the order in which our names appear here. So in that case, let me invite Bob to come and share your remarks and your view on the future of hydrology education to kick off the discussion.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Check the microphone.
Mobile. Oh, there's a mobile.
Yeah.
Oh, this one.
Yeah.
Yes,
oh, we can also just come here, and that's okay.
Yeah, just for your statement, and then we'll have the discussion here.
Right. Thank you very much for inviting me here. I'm not only a guest today, I'm also an alumnus. I started my hydrology diploma course here in 1987. I did my MSc in 1988 and 89. And afterwards, I worked for about half a year here. So I stayed actually 2 years at IHE. And then we were in another building in the old building. And I was also drinking coffees and with the computer group. So we were doing computers at that moment. And I was doing a lot of programs. So my course leader, Peter DeLatt, is here, and many of my teachers are actually here. Hank de Brun, I learned the first meteorology with you, and Henry Colombo, the tipping packet, and the Peter Van Madam hydrological model, and of course, throughout groundwater hydrology, and Volker surface hydrology. I must also say my first exam for surface hydrology, I didn't pass.
Oh.
But, I mean, Nedo and Andrea already have said that. I was educated as a hydraulic engineer, irrigation engineer. I was used to dealing with equations. I was not good at concept, you know, since that Huber was talking about. And when I came here, I mean, I was, I just couldn't understand any of those hydrological concepts. And that is basically a special sense unit hydrograph to me was just a mystery. Mm. I still don't think I understand it. Although I'm a professor for spatial hydrology and water resources management. So, but I was asked to say a few words about the future. Future is always quite difficult to predict, but we are asked to look into the next 25 years. I think from my perspective, because I'm leading the Department of Water Resources at ITC, faculty at ITC, University of Twente, we also need to discuss this type of things. My chair is spatial hydrology and water resources management. So for me, if I look at the discussion, I mean, Hoop gave a really excellent review and a look at the context. I thought Yang Xiao did the groundwater part. I'm more on the surface water. I mean, if we are still allowed to stick a little bit to the tradition, and somehow you have to belong to a family as such. And also Andrea and Nano also talk about the different parts of that. I think if I'm allowed to bridge the things a little bit, hydrology as a science, which deals with the water cycle as such, and the quality and quantity of that, I think you cannot do by just working on concepts. And that will never work. As such, hydrology is an experimental science, and it relates a lot on actually equation. In the past, if I look at what I have done after my MIC, actually, during my MSc, I had to earn my livings by working in a company in Rotterdam, Volkssteven. I was actually doing programming for groundwater modeling. So I programmed the model for them using an Auditorium computer, which we could do this mesh modeling. And well, for my MSc, I was doing number generation. And I sort of it was really stochastically generating a rainfall time series for a longer period of 50 years so that you can do hydrological planning. That was the task of my MSc thesis. And Eugene Dahmer was my supervisor, and Professor Michael was in the examination committee, so all these names are there. And I used a lot of the techniques I learned from Dr. Shaheen, statistics. So that's also something that I had no notion whatsoever. But now, if you look into the future, I think a few things that we have to realize. As I said, hydrology, in my view, is experimental science, if you want to call it science. I mean, no, we agree it is a science, it's not an engineer. Now, if that is the case, the science must be actually based on observation. Where do we obtain observation? I mean, a lot of groundwater wells are put in China, 20,000 or so. I mean, in the Netherlands, we have a lot of measurement. But just for one example, in the Netherlands, we have a lot of rain gates. So I think we know for the whole world, probably the Netherlands has the densest rain gauge network, I would say. But we still do not know what is the evaporation in the Netherlands. I hope, Hank, you will agree with me. We do not know the evaporation in the Netherlands. We know it from all these models. We know from groundwater models. We know from a marking equation. And I think what we know is upper limit of the evaporation. That is perhaps limited by the precipitation and limited by the available energy, solar energy, radiation part. Other than that, we do not know what's happening. And recently this year in the hydrology journal, in the Solman, in the Dutch professional hydrological journal, there was this paper about this new lithometer. And the measurement lithometer, if you want to take that as a tool, gives a kind of range for these values that you can expect from modeling from eddy covariance measurements. They are 20% or for 40% or for whatever, and these are just for a different and well characterized land use. In Kabul, you know, it's grassland, we say, okay, sufficient water marking should be fine, every groundwater model should be fine, measurement of eddy covariance would be fine. It is still not fine. Okay? Now, if you go to the whole failure, it's even more complicated. If you go to the forest, perhaps you have even more problems. So we do not know that. So in this case, I think we have to think about new measurement technologies in order to promote our science and to advance our science. Any technique that you can use to quantify the water cycle is helpful. In this case, precipitation, evaporation, groundwater, soil water, anything there. And from my point of view, I think space technology will play a more important role. I have been to remote sensing. I also learned remote sensing here in this institute. My first lecture was given by Massimo Menenti. I must say, I didn't understand anything he taught me. I still do not understand what he's talking about. But we are making satellites together whatsoever. I think we have to look at that. Okay, what is the development in the future? You know, satellite space technologies, what can we do for hydrological science as such. Another thing is basically sometimes we joke about the computing, but then without computing, without the computational power, we cannot parse through the large data. And perhaps we have to look at, okay, can we push for use of all the data that is available to do hydrological research? In this case, I'm referring to maybe high-performance computation, maybe big data-related things. And these are the developments here. Although predictions are difficult if you use or whatever deep learning algorithms whatsoever, but now everybody is using Google, you check things, you look at things, and perhaps we can look at that from that perspective. Then the third point I want to talk about is hydrology as a science can only sustain when there's a need for that. Okay? And this is perhaps the societal needs that is there for hydrology, and that is a sustainable development, whatever you say about the sustainable development goals, they are somehow related to water. Water is the major thing that is needed. So as such, I think we have to look at the societal needs, where that is the challenge for us, and we have to look at, okay, what is really needed to the hydrologist as such, but then we must focus on the scientific part, we must push for the technological development. As such, I think in the next years, in the coming years, the hydrological education should not focus on only traditional science concepts and whatsoever. We have to look beyond science. From a scientific point of view, from science point of view, it has been said physics, mathematics, statistics, geology. I mean, these things, I would say from my own research part, it touched a lot of these turbulence-related things. Turbulence is not something that is sorted out. So the challenge is very much. You can do all kinds of things in turbulence-related. On the other hand, from an observational point of view, if you use space technology, if you use satellites, you have to deal with radiative transfer equations. You are dealing with basically modern physics, quantum physics. A lot of those things, if we are currently building a satellite using fluorescence measurement. So in this case, I would say a combination of science, technology, and application should be the future for what we consider hydrology in the coming 25 years.
Thank you very much, Bob. Thank you. All right, well, so just to recap for what I heard that as hydrologists, we need to remain true to our roots as experimental scientists. And that's going to require work based on observation. And you pointed out there are still many important questions that need to be answered, that are hydrological questions. You pointed to the opportunities that we have in the future, the emerging new sources of data that are provided by space-based monitoring technologies. You pointed to the opportunities that we have with increasing computational power to analyze those data. And you also made the important point that in order to be successful, we must make ourselves relevant. And we make ourselves relevant by linking to the important issues and challenges that the world is facing today. Does that sound like it? All right, wonderful. Thank you for kicking us off with those important points. Next, you're back.
Hey. Yeah. Okay, I'll be considerate with the audience. I've already had half an hour of talk, so I'm going to be very brief. I have, in fact, 2 points to make. And I'm not going to talk about the science of hydrology anymore, but more about the context. So why are we teaching hydrology and why is it important? And what does that mean for the way how we teach hydrology and also the substance of our courses? And that all has to do with context. So what I'm going to talk about is the context. There are two things in the context that I think are most important. First is the Sustainable Development Goals and the role of hydrology within that, and the other is dealing with change. So a few words about the Sustainable Development Goals. We of course have seen the picture with the 17 colored pictures of, I think it's 17 or maybe it's even more, Sustainable Development Goals, and I think Sustainable Development Goal number 7 is blue, and Guy, you must have been behind this, it's called water and sanitation for everybody.
Number six.
It's called water and sanitation for everybody. This is a bloody scandal. Because it is water as an essential resource for development. This is how it has been defined. But water and sanitation people in the very last end said, this is what people don't understand. Let's call it water and sanitation for all, which was the Millennium Development Goal. So that has nothing to do with sustainable development. So it's really an outrage that this is called water and sanitation for all. Because it is water for sustainable development. And it is connected to almost all sustainable development goals, which is food, poverty, energy, housing, economic growth, there are more, education, everything. It's linked to everything. And if we as water people fail to see that connection, we are in trouble. And there's also big talk among the SDG people on do these goals not conflict with each other? Like if you say we have the sustainable development goals on economic growth, does that not hamper the poor? Or does that not hamper the environment, which is also a goal? Water is not conflicting with anything. Water sustains them all. There is no environment without water, there are no people without water. Everything is connected to water. Water is the linking pin. And if we are not going to emphasize this, but also in our education emphasize this, it means that we do our education in a different way. It's something that integrates everything. That was number one. Brief, right? Yeah. Number two is dealing with change. Because we are in a rapidly changing world. It's not climate change only, it's what we people do to the world, that everything is changing. And we have to understand hydrology as an active agent within change. This is why IHS, and you probably know that I'm the president of IHS, IHS has defined change as the key element for the next decade, which we call Pantarai. Pantarai means everything is flowing, everything is changing, and water is the crucial linking pin that connects all these changes. So in hydrology, look at change and look at the links with the sustainable development goals. That was
Thank
my point.
Thank you very much. Crystal clear and also connected in calling for us as a hydrological community to engage solidly in and us as a, let's say, UNESCO-IHE hydrology community to engage directly in the SDG process. and in the processes such as Pantere, where we need to be very active as participants in that. It isn't, it's an unfortunate title for goal number six. Fortunately, there are six targets under goal six, which does include water for water quality, water for agriculture, water for ecosystems. It includes integrated. It's an example of some diplomatic process and other things, I guess, to survive as a standalone goal. Fortunately, we do have quite a bit of international enabling inside of the details of the SDGs and an opportunity to have a strong impact. And it does, it relates to many of the other goals, as you pointed out, as well. All right, let's continue. I just took my glasses off, though. You guys know who's next?
No.
Ah, that's right.
That's always a problem.
So I have two slides prepared.
All right. Oh,
excellent.
Yeah, well, yeah.
So here you can.
I don't have to remember anything.
Find those here. Let's see, Yang Xiao, it's in this folder, probably.
Yeah.
Can you switch?
Yeah. All right.
So that's what you get if you have a free assignment, or where is it?
It's tough.
Okay. Basically, you get a very different. Way people work it out. So I just put up two slides. One is hydrology and research, which I think are important for the coming 20, 25 years. And one thing I actually start with something that I took home from the AGU conference of the Longbine lecture by Jane Kirshner. And I think, Hupa, you were there as well. He ended actually with calling for, basically referring to this battle that we have to be fighting as scientists, which is between fact and opinion. You basically see that what is truth is moving from fact-finding that we are as scientists we're used to doing to basically having a well-versed opinion. And it becomes more and more difficult to battle wrong opinions with correct facts. Because people just say, well, you know, that is what you find. But I think it's this. You see it also with the climate skeptics, where one climate skeptic can actually overrule 10,000 scientists, if given the right podium. So that is something we really have to be concerned about. And also, in terms of researchers, we have to figure out some way of dealing with this, maybe using better channels of communicating and teaching people what science is about and so on, and what science brought us actually in terms of prosperity. Well, that's what I want to start with. Another thing I think is that this is a little bit related to that. Basically, science and fact is based by a peer review system. That peer review system is severely under pressure. Because you get so many review requests as a scientist these days, because the scientific community is growing, and it's also growing with a lot of people that still are basically just entering the science arena. So we have to deal with this vast number of papers and see how we can actually deal with them and still remain high standards, and that's very difficult because it's all voluntary work, of course. Maybe we need to figure out a new system of quality control that also is strong enough to basically win the battle against opinions. So that is something we have to think about. I don't know the answer yet, but that is something as a scientist we have to think about. Then a little bit hydrology. The first point is, I think, something that is going to come. I mean, I'm one of the people working on what I could large extent hyper-resolution modeling and observations, or it's not only modeling, which means that you try to be locally relevant everywhere. We still have to overcome a lot of obstacles to go there, but it's something we are thinking about. And also, one of the things that has to do with also with the Pantere initiative, one of the main parts of that is the human factor in our hydrological system understanding. The two-way interaction between humans and
the water system. That is something that I think is going to flourish as a research discipline in the coming decade. And it's already beginning. Mostly it's stylized models that you also see in ecology, in systems ecology. But agent-based type of modeling approaches and so on will also be are also knocking on the door. And then there's big data. Big data, there's a lot to do about big data. And big data are mostly right now used for prediction. So you do deep learning techniques or machine learning techniques and you predict something. And it's very successful. But obviously it remains a black box. What's underneath the hood? And I think the use of big data, but not for prediction, but for hypothesis and theory testing, that is something we still need to develop. Which means we try to derive actual, physical, or ecological, or biological theories from big data. That is something that we still want to do, need to do. And in terms of water management, I'm still foreseeing these virtual basins where we have something like a holographic projection that is really fueled by real models that are really mass and energy and momentum conserving and can basically help us to very quickly design stuff and also see the results of that real time. So there are some of the things I'm thinking about for the coming decades. In terms of education, what you see now is that distance learning is basically coming up very strongly. But to me, I think it will reach its peak. It will not be taking over regular learning because people really want to interact with other people to be taught, like a master pupil relationship. So even if you think about things like flipped classroom, your idea about flipped classroom is that you use e-learning to create time to have more in-depth interaction between the students and the tutor. So I think that will also remain. Maybe it's more of a hope than a projection, but I hope this will remain at least. The science in context, Ruud was already alluding to that, is also important. We have to teach our students not only the science, but also what it means for equity, the integrity of scientific research, and being credible. And then I'm relating again against this opinion fact battle. How do you remain credible as a scientist against 100 million opinions on Twitter or Fox News? Hydrology itself, if we think about, I'm thinking that global hydrology as a course, these are just a number of courses I think that I foresee that are not being taught but are on the edge of research that will be regular courses in the near future. So with that, that's my pitch. Thanks.
Perfectly clear when it's on the screen, so thank you. We'll be able to refer back to those that we need to during the discussion period. Yeah. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. So on what we call in the Netherlands the shortest day of the year, the 21st of December, at least on this hemisphere, we celebrate the long and dynamic history of the hydrology course here at IHE and later UNESCO-IHE. So from Wageningen University, congratulations IHE on 50 years of hydrology course.
Thank you.
Yeah, whenever you turn hydrology, or sorry, whenever you turn 50, it's actually time to take stock and look earlier today. And as a group, actually last year, a hydrology group in Wageningen, we also turned 50. We also had our celebration. We looked back and also looked ahead. And actually earlier this year, I turned 50 myself. And also that is an appropriate occasion to sometimes, look back a bit and take stock and try to focus on the future. And when I look at hydrology, at our discipline, I think we're very good at building walls inside our discipline. And I would like to make a plea for tearing down those walls. And I'm going to give just a couple of examples. For instance, when we talk about hydrological modeling, right? Typically, the Hydrology 101 course starts with a distinction of hydrological models in either a black box or conceptual or physics or physically based models. Let's stop with that. You know, there is a continuum of models, and the models that are so-called physics based hopefully will teach us how, you know, emerging properties help us to build so-called conceptual models. And on the other hand, other side of the spectrum are black box models, which are often, you know, statistically based on pure observations, may help us teach some of the concepts in, you know, what we now call conceptual models. So I would say, you know, let's tear down those walls between those three different types of models, and let's tear down the walls between the people supposedly working in each of those three, you know, separate rooms of the house that is called hydrology, because that's not, you know, helping the science and the education of hydrology any further, I think. So that's one example of tearing down the walls. Second example is, you know, whenever you introduce yourself as a hydrologist at a conference, you know, with earth scientists or with engineers, whatever, you know, the first question you get is like, are you a modeler or are you an experimentalist? You know, let's stop with that, you know. Where, you know, in our science we need both models as well as experiments, right? So you can't build a model without having data, right? A model without data is useless. You can't even conceive a model if you don't have data to start with. You can't, you know, estimate its parameters. You can't verify or falsify a model without data. So, you know, we need both models and we need data, we need experiments. So, you know, as hydrologists, we should be modelers and experimentalists at the same time. So that's a second wall I would like to see being torn down in the next 25 or 50 years. And then maybe finally, as far as education is concerned, I think there's plenty of room for, you know, development there. I think our educational programs at this moment are still, well, quite conservative. They look very much like, I think, the programs we taught 25 or even sometimes 50 years ago in terms of their structure. Yes, we have computers. Yes, we have new measurement techniques. We have remote sensing. We have crowdsourcing. But in essence, you know, we still teach our typical hydrology classes with our computer practicals, our field practicals. And I think there's ample opportunity to make use, better use, much better use than we currently do of all the recent technological development. Use more, let's say, for instance, knowledge clips to have students prepare for their field excursions, not from scratch, but in that way they will be better prepared for field excursions. And in that way, during field excursions, we will be able to, as teachers, to better relate to our students and actually teach them about, you know, the science of what we're doing, rather than explaining them how, you know, one particular instrument or method works. You know, that can be prepared and done beforehand. And actually, in that sense, we can borrow quite a bit from, you know, neighboring disciplines, where we see a rapidly growing student number. So I think we can make use of those technological advances without sacrificing actually the quality of our education, no, actually even improving it. So that's my 5 cents. And well, congratulations again with your 50th anniversary. And I hope you'll still be here for the 100 years, you know, in 50 years time. Okay.
Okay, well, thank you very much to our panel members. They've laid out a vision of the next 25 years from their points of view. When I listened to you, I heard at least three sort of categories of future visions. One related to the content. So I think Mark's sort of hydrology section here reflects that. that inside of the discipline or the content of our study, the scope of our study, there are opportunities for growth and change. There was another section that was about our modalities of teaching and education. And can we be more imaginative? Can we make use of more recent approaches and technologies? But as Mark said, are we already sort of peaking in some of those? I mean, these are debatable, and some of you may not agree with all of them. I think those of us with children that are in the, well, almost at any age now, but children that are 20 or younger, we just see a whole new way of interacting and really feeling kind of an identity online as well. So I'm not sure, how that upcoming way of interacting with each other may eventually come into the classroom. And then the final category, though, that I heard, and this is it was mentioned by a few of you, is a bit about our own identity. The tearing down the walls is a good, very illustrative way of saying that. That in identifying ourselves, we will do well to tear down some of these walls and accept and the continuum and benefit from what comes from seeing it as a continuum. Now, normally, there would be some exchange among the panel members themselves, but the audience has been so extraordinarily patient through the series of presentations that we have that I really want to immediately hand it over to you. And so let me invite you now to add, if you wish, a perspective on the next 25 years and something that you think should be brought into the discussion. And I also welcome you to ask questions about, to challenge, anything that you've heard here already today. Who would like to begin?
I'm happy that this last...
I'm sorry, we will have to use the microphone. This is our new microphone. So
you can throw it.
The beauty of this microphone is that there's no more like walking around and slowly handing it to everyone. Are you ready for this?
That's great.
All right. Ask your question. Yeah, you still need, yeah.
I'm just happy that this loud light of Mark is there. Because what I miss is the most important thing in hydrology, and I feel that after 45 years to be active in hydrology, that the most complicated thing in hydrology is the observations, measurements. Yeah, how to measure, what are you measuring, and so on. And that is just what I am missing. And here also, the first step of the data analysis is not mentioned. So how to get high quality data? That is, I think, very important, and that students have more to learn in the field and to watch processes and so on and to measure them. I think that is important for hydrology.
Thank you. Would someone like to react to that?
Yeah.
There's complete agreement on the stage.
The box is yours.
Then I do measurements as well, but then you have to define the scale in time. And I come back to, if you see hydrology as an integrated part, then you must do measurements on the scale. What do you modeling, etc. And so there's a difference between a lysimeter and a scintillometer, to be in my hobby. And the scintillometer does measurements on a kilometer scale, and a lysimeter on 1 point scale. And I think that's, we must think about that.
And the remote sensing at...
so that is, so the science itself should define the correct scale, and don't leave it to the people who do the measurements.
But don't forget also the system scale of the catchment.
That's the new opportunity.
Yeah,
that's what I mean. Yeah. I'd like to respond. First of all, I of course fully agree with what Pete Warmerdam mentioned about data collection, and not just data collection. I think we're actually gaining information, hydrological information from the data, not
very surprising that I agree with Pete since he taught me hydrology 25 years ago. And also agree with Henk's statements about the relevance of scale. Of course, nowadays what we see, and I think Mark was also alluding to that, in addition to all the, let's say, the dedicated instrumentation that we have available worldwide, so instrumentation that was designed and installed and is maintained for the purpose of collecting hydrological or meteorological data, there are also many, many, let's say, sensors of opportunity, let's call them like that. So our world nowadays is full of sensors, and we're using our smartphones to communicate. We can also use our smartphones, or at least many of them, to measure environmentally relevant variables. And there's tons of infrastructure out there, and I would really also like to make a plea, as hydrological community, let's embrace that development, let's make use of those opportunistic sensors, combine them with our dedicated instruments to obtain and collect better data for doing our science, basically.
So let's definitely agree that there are very exciting possibilities today and on the horizon for new means of data collection at different scales and from citizen to trained observer, and that we need to convert that information that's flowing in through proper analysis into useful information. Clear for all of us. Yes, Theo, and then I see a hand at the back. That's going to be a long throw.
I do another point that I had in mind. That is an opportunity. Nowadays, I say to every student, when I finish my study, I learned Fortran, and I learned Excel sheets. But now, what you should learn is Python and QGIS. And the point is, with Python, you can do everything. Yeah? Do the internet, invert 1,000 by 1,000 matrix, everything at all at your PC, it's free. With QGIS, you could do analysis. You can download the satellites from the world. So it doesn't matter nowadays if you work like in a small village in Africa, or in another small village in China, you can do it. And there's no excuse not having these tools in your pocket your whole life, because they're free. They're free. Not only that, this Python and QGIS is going to be, or already is going to be, or is the letters or the English assigned to a community. All these groups, and it can also be R, all these groups work together. So if you are behind the wall in Palestine, you can work together with Germany, with Africa. You can do that. So why are we not doing that in this course all over the place?
Ooh.
That's my goal. I'm going to do it tomorrow. I have all my lectures now in Jupyter Notebooks.
So
I put them
no MATLAB anymore, Python.
No, I put them on GitHub yesterday, and I will present them in Read the Docs. They're on the web for everybody to use, and it's just great. So that was my point about this. So if you are not doing this, we are old-fashioned as professors. That's my point. The other thing, and that was about the opinion. Should we not also teach clear thinking? Because I was so astonished that so many students think or thought that water bridging is something that can be scientifically proven or something.
You
think so many beliefs. Should we not introduce or show how to think?
I think it's a matter of. Nena was suggesting if you just hold it, then it's.
How to think clearly to split between opinion and reality. We have scientific tools for that, and that is double-blind analysis.
Yeah.
And we should teach it.
Critical thinking, as our I'll take it, and we'll find the right route. Send it up to Guy up there.
Ik denk dat het veel
All right, so the question is a follow-up. So here
we go, guys.
Here we are amongst smart people, educated people, and we talk about sophisticated models and how to do better, etc. But when we look at the the developing world, including India, although that's not really a developing country any longer, we do find that despite the fact that the importance of water is actually increasing day by day for the next 50 years, the amount of money spent on hydrological networks, data collection, quality of data is declining. So if you go and ask people from the World Bank or ADB, you will find that the message generally is that governments are spending actually less money on apparently this very important part of the story. So how can you propose means to create an argument to ministers of finance and to ministers of water resources, ministers of agriculture, to spend and invest more in the hardware, not just in fancy models, but in actually the data that you need to calibrate the models to make them useful? I think that's a major challenge.
I think the short answer to that is you can't efficiently manage your water if you don't have data to combine with your models. So you're actually losing money if you don't collect data. I'm sure Mark is a statement.
Well, you have to prove that. That's the problem. I mean, you can say that, and I, as a scientist, say, yeah, you're right. But this Minister of Finance, he's not convinced. You have to do the calculations. You basically have to say, okay, what's the money you're losing if you're not measuring properly? And then there's another thing. I mean, the classical way of measuring, we should probably forego that, because you place a rain gauge at some location, of course, that's the best thing to do. But you have to maintain it. You have to have some person going there every time. That's not going to happen anymore. So you need to find other sensing techniques that may be not as stationary for a long time, but they're easily distributed, and you basically sample space and time in a different way, not as time series at one location, but at multiple locations at different times. Because that's the only way you're probably going to maintain that. I see Nano sighing because he wants to have 50 observations at one location. Oh. I would love that as well. But the reality of it is that it's not going to be feasible anymore, especially if countries start to develop and labor is becoming more and more expensive. It's not going to happen. You're not going to have those, say, colonial times networks anymore. We have to find something else.
Of course, I fully agree with you both. But there is something else that we need to think of. That is, we are all talking about change. And change means that we also have to observe change. I know that many people say, oh, but these historical records, you can use them to calibrate your models, and then you don't need the network anymore. But in an environment that is changing, we should monitor change. And this is also a message to engineers. They do interventions, sometimes building big dams and things, but then they say, okay, now project is over, but then we want to see what the effect is. And investments in big projects, there's always money for that. But investment in projects should be accompanied by installation of a network to monitor what the effect of the project will be. And you can actually include that in project proposals. In fact, you can demand it, because you could say, look, we want to know what the effect of the project is. That's an environmental and societal impact. So we should, in planning of interventions, include the monitoring of the effect.
Is yours related to this exact thing? Neno like jumped out of his seat on this particular question. So why don't we send it to him, and then
all right,
then it's back up to you.
Once I was playing basketball, I really have to react on this one. Thank you for raising the question of data and for your intervention. Like this.
There you go, that's right.
Yeah.
We're learning.
Get closer to your mouth.
Like this.
Yeah.
Yeah. And very, very good point. from Guy. Now I'm reacting as a hydrologist, groundwater person, because at IBEC we set up an own initiative, and you were there, Mark, as well, in 2007, Global Groundwater Monitoring Network. You know, so bold, so arrogant, but we did it. And so far, we've been in 60 countries and developing system, collecting data, and I don't say we did a lot, but there's no the other way. Without ground truthing and change what you said, we can't do, we can't really have a reliable prediction. Now, modern technology, cell phones and the other things are helping a lot, but when we talk about groundwater, it's a little bit more difficult. Your very good remark, Guy, is how I see it. As a hydrologist, as a scientist, we don't think very often in terms of economic of what we are doing, of business part of what we are doing. And I see nowadays that large investors, banks, investment companies, insurances, they look at their investments in a corporate business where companies are which use water and groundwater, and how risky are their investments. So there is also where we have to search for additional investment and include monitoring what you're saying. Who's the next one?
Back to Micha.
Thank you. Well, I will not speak about the data, but I'd like to raise the issue of theoretical hydrology a little bit in command to what Remco said. I think that theoretical hydrology can go as a subdiscipline itself. And let me give an example for which I was working last 2 years. I was doing projects on the disposal of radioactive waste in the clay layers. And for that topic, you need to look forward 1 million years. I think it's the only environmental issue where you are asked to look forward 1 million years. But that also implies, and we were wondering, does chemical osmosis play a role or not? And it's pretty hard to study chemical osmosis, also because in the short time range, diffusion is very important. So I think for that kind of questions, you actually need to do theoretical hydrology, and you're not possible to do proper measurements because of the long time scale. And that's more general, I think, in hydrology. We deal with very, very slow processes, which can become very important in the long term. And the only way actually you can deal with it is with the theoretical modeling.
That's partly true, because you can also do experimentation in the lab, and you speed up time, basically. That's not always possible, but there are certain things that you can actually speed up time by doing clever experimentation, scaling the things, so that at least you don't have to always use full calculations to do that. So there's other ways to do that, Jasper, I think. You agree?
Yes and no. Sometimes you can speed up things, but characteristic like diffusion versus chemical osmosis, where the one grows with the square root of time, the other linear in time, it's pretty hard to change that fundamental characteristics of the process.
But how were those fundamental characteristics established in the first place?
Yeah, exactly. By observation, of course. Yeah.
Exactly. So hence my point, basically.
No, but still, some processes like chemical osmosis are very, very hard to observe in the field. There's only one proper field study done where they managed to study it, and many people are convinced that it plays a role in the field.
Can I just add one to the data point? Yeah. I think everybody agrees that we have to have more observation. This has been for the last 20 years, 50 years, as far as hydrology is concerned. Actually, it's for everything. Renko mentioned that cell phone technologies, I said about space technology. I think for the hydrological discipline, we have to look at what is developing in the technological field so that we can keep on developing our science. If you do not look at that, I mean, nobody is going to invest in a lot of more brain gauges and a lot of more groundwater observation wells and whatsoever. And you see, this is a common complaint, we have seen that. But why don't we look at other technologies that are developing so fast? I mean, nobody is investing in a fixed line telephone because everybody is using new technology. So I think we have to look at that. So the challenge is that when we are doing teaching, we should also teach those courses that are relevant, not only stick to the traditional way. I mean, you said maybe it's 25 years, I'm not quite sure, but perhaps we can do some innovation, not necessarily e-learning, but something else that you need broaden that. I mean, programming is certainly important, and other things are equally important.
Thank you. I'm definitely hearing that very clearly. Mika,
yeah.
And then back to the front, please.
No, thanks. It's funny, yesterday I was at a session where we were talking about the future of forecasting, and someone came up with a remark in the audience and said, we're being overwhelmed by big data, let's say, and so we don't have time for basic understanding of the processes. And so I was just wondering, indeed, as a question, are we sufficiently equipped, perhaps in education, but also in methods, to be able to deal rigorously with big data and not, as Marek maybe put it, become opinionated ourselves because we've got this tide of data coming over us that how do we link it, let's say, to processes, etc. Just a question.
Yeah, I think that's a good point, and of course that already supposes that the data are there, right? Because of course availability and access to data is another major issue, I think, that we're dealing with in our community. Many of the data that are collected in many parts of the world, including in the Netherlands, are kept by the agencies that collect the data and are not freely available to the community, to the citizens, or to the scientists, or to the water managers to actually use. And so the plea for open access and freeware in terms of our models and modeling environments should, in principle, also hold, I think, for data, in particular, if they are collected using taxpayers' money, basically. And,
yeah, what I was, when you have this huge amount of data, basically, you can do maybe two things. You can derive a fully black, well, I'm just going back to your different boundaries, but you can somehow use machine learning type of techniques to find a predictive model. You can fit a preconceived model that you think how the world works. What I was meaning with this remark is we can also, we have not used that in that sense a lot, try to distill what the underlying mechanics of the process are by looking at the data. And that is something that we are only beginning to do, I think. And that may be improve predictability in the end. Especially if you go to long lead times.
You want to follow up on this, Bob, and then or?
Yeah, I just want to quickly add one thing. If you look at the hydrology, so far we have been actually doing simulation a lot, and I think we should push for predictions. I mean, although Mark was screaming with that, if you look at the weather prediction, if you look at the European Center for Medium Range Weather Forecast, their advances are actually propelled by that they have to be good in prediction. If we say, okay, we want to predict the next 100 years, 50 years, 10 years, 1 year, a system, a week, daily, it requires something different than what we have been doing. And we have to be able to build that capability. Can we do that? That is a scientific question. Can we do that? It's a technological question. Can we do that? It's availability of data. But we have to be able to actually to be able to face that challenge. If we are saying we cannot do that, I mean, we are useless for policy people for making planning, even for making management. I mean, related to disaster whatsoever, you want to be prepared. You don't want to always look back. You want to look forward.
Yeah.
What is to help policymakers? If you can tell all these politicians in coming years something is going to happen and whatsoever, you will be always at the table.
Thank you. I mean, I think we're identifying some really fundamental shifts in the source of the information that we apply in our science. Please continue.
Yeah, I was reacting on the question about theory and experiment. I come from the field of atmospheric turbulence, and that's chaos. And you can only reach some results of this so-called similarity theories. So you say this one, this is irrelevant, and the other one is relevant, and then you come up with simple rules. And these must be calibrated with experiments, by definition. And if I look to most in the meteorology, weather forecasting, we solve turbulence, 2D turbulence, in the same way. And then experiment and theory are connected by definition. And I want to see in hydrology the same approach. We have a problem. If you look to one single water molecule, we know everything. But if we have two or more in a complex soil, it's chaos. So you must try to, out of the chaos, to develop the rules of thumb. And that's the challenge. And I'm not the first one to say that. In the particle physics, we have exactly the same. We have the Higgs boson is discovered now. But we learn from that there's a Higgs boson. But if we have many Higgs bosons, we know nothing.
This is a fundamental thing that I disagree with you, because at the system scale, you see emerging properties.
Yeah.
And this is done by an active agent, and that's the ecosystem. It creates conditions for survival.
We do not disagree. But I don't think that you come up with fundamental rules as is in physics. This emergency is per definition chaos, but we can go to rules by measurements and theory. That's my opinion. Yeah.
All right. Hale and then Anne. And these are perhaps more comments on this particular topic. We need to pay attention to the time. And one thing I would just like to ask if anyone has something they would like to share about modalities, you know, about the way that we are teaching and communicating, imparting knowledge in the classroom, I would be happy to hear a final remark about that. But we'll have two more remarks. If there's something more about modalities, let's do that. And otherwise, we need to move to the closure of the session because we'll be able to continue these discussions downstairs. Theo, please.
Okay. So we're talking about data and models and big data even and getting out of there the fundamental relations. I don't think it will work. What you will get out of that is correlations. The next thing is thinking, is hypothesizing, and then testing that. And that is the fundamental difference. You cannot get fundamental relations just by analyzing data. Now you get only correlations. But it's the theory that you have to put down underneath it and test it to make use of it. So data alone is not going to work. And especially in the future. And what we're doing in groundwater is calibrating. But what we're hardly doing is predicting, including all the uncertainties, so that we can include the situation that have never existed before. And that's also the surface water hydrology. You can look to the past, but things are changing. How are you going to prove, taking into consideration, situations that have never existed before? Last more remark, I think you missed chemistry in your list. I don't even know if you agree with that.
I think we can hardly disagree with what you just said.
I already had a question which is a bit out of the context, but more to the education, because it's an important element. And it's maybe a worry, because it's we are celebrating 50 years of hydrology education at UNESCO-IHE. But it's also, I think, a watershed moment because the Institute is losing contact with UNESCO. So I wonder, are we also at the peak of international education on hydrology from the Netherlands? So what's the vision on it?
Maybe a question for you,
Mike. Yeah. Well, thank you. This is a tough final question to ask.
for me, I mean, I take heart in the fact that this program for 50 years has been fully internationally focused. And it was before the relationship with UNESCO, and it continued and maybe expanded and was enhanced by that relationship. We are changing our relationship with UNESCO. We will still have an affiliation as a Category 2 center, and to a lot of the outside world, whether we're Category 1 or Category 2 is not important. They will just still see that this is an institution that has made a commitment to align its efforts to a degree with the efforts of the international community as represented by the mission of UNESCO. So I hope it's not the end. It would only be the end, I think, if the Dutch government that has been so generous for so many decades in supporting something that was so obviously international, rather than, I mean, supports will continue to the universities because it's also that fundamental training for the Dutch citizenry, with a sprinkling and a strong sprinkling of international students as well. But when it comes to this institution, it's about the international community and our relationship with that international community. So I'm just hoping it's almost more of a political question, perhaps, and I know there's some worries about that right now. Let's talk about that over drinks. Dimitri, a final remark. You want to throw the box?
Look, I haven't thought that it would be a final remark, but I'd like to connect to what I'm saying. And I am returning back to 25 years ago. We started with Hoop on the same day in this institute, interestingly enough. It's one statement. Second, I remember we were discussing how the new course would called hydroinformatics would look like, and we had very similar things discussed 25 years ago, and it means we still have a lot to do. So I'm inviting all hydrologists to work closer to hydroinformaticians, and I'm happy to hear machine learning coming up, big data and stuff like this. So I think this is what connects hydrology to technology, and technologies are information technology, but many other things that are feeding into hydrology and make it flourish, in fact. And one point I would like to make is this, about the hydrology course and many other courses at IHE. Actually, if Bill Seyfran would have go to a financial department and say, look, I have an idea to transform diploma course into master course. If it would have been happening now, he would be blocked by financial department saying we have no money for it. So master education at IHE would have never happened if we'd be using models of today then. Yeah. So I would like to invite everybody, including management of this institute and future management as well and all staff, to take a bit of risk and have a vision into the future in education and research. And not only look at the examples when companies are successfully managed by accountants, but also at many examples when engineers allow accountants to run companies and then companies fail because it's very often short-term vision and not long-term vision. So with this, I would like to invite to think during drinks more.
Thank you very much. That was extremely practical, and you do have to remember that those practical realities are many times the controlling variables in what we can do as an institution and as a program.
Michael, can I say something to Anne?
Just to Anne,
just,
yes.
Yeah, just yeah. To Anne's question, just very short, in fact. As the four of us are sitting here, we are all professors of hydrology in four universities where hydrology is an extremely important subject. Utrecht, Wageningen, Twente, and Delft. And we are here at the IHE, not because we are Dutch professors who are purely interested in hydrology, because we see that our field of work is internationally. And the fact that IHE is here is valuable for all four of us. Yeah. We support IHE. So we from our side would never allow IHE to be damaged by, let's say, nationalistic thinking. We have to see IHE as a very, very important institute to study the hydrology of the world, but also to educate the hydrologists and the water managers of the world. And I think I can speak for all of you, we will support you fully.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. One sentence to add to and IHE will be not disconnected from the UNESCO hydrological program.
Yeah. And hopefully in a couple of years' time there will not be four gray males here, but long live diversity, including gender diversity.
What do you mean by gray?
I don't call my hair one.
Yes, please. Yes. All right. Thanks to our panel. Please, it's not yet time to leave. Yes, my apologies if I gave the signal that we. I know that some people may need to step out, and I knew that ahead of time. So, but we have a final point in our program. I'm sorry I do not have more time to reflect upon the discussion that's just taken place. But let me just say that I heard it very clearly. It has provoked a lot of thinking for me. And I'm very happy with the members of the Hydrology and Water Resources Chair Group that are here as well, along with our participants, that we've all been part of this discussion together, because for the internal process of us benefiting from the contributions that have been made by all of you who we know are our supporters and an extension of what we're trying to do here. We need to take it to heart and to process it and to use it to guide us in how we will continue to develop our own program to make it as effective and impactful as possible, but also to continue to have a very productive collaboration with you and beyond these walls. So there have been several references during the presentations, especially when we were thinking about the history of this institution, to the awards in hydrological education that were provided 25 years ago. And we saw the awardees, we heard a bit about the purpose of the award. It really was an award designed to recognize and to give credit to thank individuals who had been fundamental in the creation of the program and also carrying the program successfully through those 25 years. That's what we'd like to do today as well. In our remaining moments, we would like to recognize and award the efforts of three of our own staff members who took the baton from those founders of the program and have carried the program forward to today with 25 or more years of continuous and dedicated service to the hydrology program. So that's the context of the award today. And I'd like to invite Fritz to come and give the award.
So the first colleague is Peter Delatte. We like to ask to come to the stage. He was starting in 1972 in this institute, and he worked for 37 years, I like to repeat it, 37 years until you retire 2009. And you are one of the persons Andrea was talking about, who builds a bridge between engineering hydrology and soil and water plant relations and trying to find this middle position between the two pillars. And I don't know the exact number of the MSc students you supervised. I think it's a lot, and see, hydrology in developing countries, you really made sure that there was a high quality education here, and the students after the MSc went back to the countries and ensured a development of really a high-quality hydrology there. And I think this is one of the major impacts this institute provided. And it is said that you had been the program coordinator by birth for this. So, and you served for a long time. And I think what is also important, what was mentioned today, not only work at the desk, reading books and writing papers, you, I think, had been the person who initiated the whole field trip program, because to make sure that that there is a clear bridge between the more theoretical part and the high need of observations at the end of the day and the understanding. And you are called the father of hydrology at IHE during the celebration of your retirement 2009. And I think all in all, this is a really good reason to award you with the IHE Hydrology Education Award.
I'm very pleased with this reward. Of course, I was here also 25 years ago when the other professors were receiving a reward. They were 25 years. I was 37 indeed, I think. But the point was, I started working here at 72, but I was not allowed to lecture at that time because Professor Mosterman said you're too young. I was 28, and it took 2 years before I started, but fortunately I could make it up, because in 2009 when I retired, I had another, was it 6-7 years or so? Last year was the last year that I still was lecturing here. And as I said, I have done that always with great pleasure. And particularly also the last year when I was doing the workshop, hydrology, it gives you a lot of pleasure to see that participants understand what they have been taught. Although now we talk about education, I found that with all these PowerPoints, people try to have too many subjects in 1 hour, too many topics, and that the essence sometimes, of course, has to be brought back when I do the workshop. That's very important. So, I'm very pleased. Thank you very much.
The second one is Jan Nonner. Jan also is an important figure, if you allow me to say, in the field of hydrology in the institute. You established the groundwater hydrology specialization, and one of the important trademarks you set up in this institute was your textbook, Introduction in Hydrogeology. And this was one of the very popular books for the students. They used to understand hydrogeology, but also to prepare for the exams. And I think what I learned when I heard about your time at UNESCO-IHE, you had been called a supervisor by birth. And I think this is something what sometimes is underestimated in this institute, because I think supervision in this institute is a different challenge, you allow me to say that, than supervision in TU Delft, for example. And I think this important element is one of our strengths in the institute. And sometimes I think we should try to learn from your way of supervision for today, how to really get our students moving to get successfully the MSc exam done. Not only the theoretical part, but also the supervision of the thesis. So I think this is something very important I like to mention, and I think this is a good reason to give you the IHE Hydrological Education Award. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Okay. If you like to say
it. Yeah, a few words from my side. I'm flabbergasted because I might have not been here. We were discussing at home, shall I come or not? So in the end, it was a good choice to be here because I very much like to spend. What Fietz has said about the supervision, I think these were words that I really appreciate, and I can only add that I always very much liked to supervise and to guide the students during their MSc work, but also I must say I very much like to teach, and that was also one of the, I think one of the reasons that I wrote the book, this textbook on hydrology, because I really have this this tendency to transfer knowledge, not only in the classroom, but also in written text. Thank you very much, and I hope to see you more often. Yeah.
In most cases, awards are given to people they are old, retired, and mostly males.
And gray hair.
And gray hair, yes, as you know. What is now, what I appreciate very much that you, Yang Shao, have been selected to get the third award. And I think this is a very nice occasion to really appreciate the work you're doing in hydrology. And I know from personal discussions that you are very much involved in groundwater hydrology, what is, I think, sometimes an underestimated issue. And I think if it comes to practical questions, and if I see my latest experiences, especially in India, then I think the whole issue of groundwater hydrology is becoming more and more important. But also the country you are coming from is an important address to deal in a competent way with groundwater hydrology. And you are a really passionate teacher. This we know from your students. And you are really a productive researcher. This is also important to build a bridge between what we are doing in research with what we are teaching in the field of hydrology and what we are doing in education. And this is important because this is the important thing where you build the bridge between this institute and your home country. You are a good project leader, and I think the projects you initiated built a bridge between this institute and China, but moreover also between the Netherlands and China. And I think this is quite important because this institute is, in one or the other way, a door opener because of this affiliation with UNESCO. And I think, therefore, your tailor-made group trainings you initiated and executed in China, this is a good reason that you educated hydrology ambassadors here in the institute to China, and therefore I appreciate very much your work, and I am really I really find it very nice that you get the Hydrology Education Award as a still active, and I think for a couple of years active teacher and educator in this institute.
What can I say more? I have said half an hour already. So this will keep me continuing to work for the next 10 years. Thank you very much.
Well, we have now reached the end of our program, and I thank you all for being with us. It's been a wonderful afternoon. It's been, I think, a worthwhile celebration of the accomplishment of 50 years. So we now have a nice reception waiting for us downstairs. The participants that are with us, thank you so much for being here. You were quite quiet. But during this reception, I want to ask you, find one of these people that's been speaking. Introduce yourself to them and ask them the question that you didn't ask during the program. But take the opportunity to engage and meet with these folks. They will be very happy to meet you, I'm sure. So please join me for a final round of applause, and we're off.
Hij was organisator die in Gelderland onderzoekscentrum werkte hij toen in 1972 met hem.
Ja,
jij werkte daarbij.